key question you might get is, what is the effect if, right, the IRS makes affirmative allegations in the answer, but, and the taxpayer does not file a reply? The short answer, right, is that those matters will be deemed denied unless the IRS files a motion, right? And they would file a motion to have matters alleged in the answer deemed admitted for purposes of the case. It's known as a Rule 37C motion, and it is filed under Rule 37C of the tax court rules. So just keep in mind, with the reply, generally not required, but if the IRS files a Rule 37C motion that is not responded to or a reply is not filed, all of those matters are going to be deemed admitted, which means that the IRS just met its burden of production and burden of proof with respect to the additional tax or the additional penalty being asserted or the fraud allegation being asserted. So it can be pretty significant. Let's talk about joinder of issue. This is generally a confusing concept to people, right? You say, well, what does it mean to have joinder of issue, right? There's a separate rule that talks about joinder of issue, and your discovery rules tell you that no discovery may be commenced until the issue is joined. That is the significance of the joinder of issue rules, right? Is that courts want to allow the parties time to get settled with the case, to get familiar with the facts within their file, before they start engaging in extensive discovery. So a case is generally at issue, right? It is at issue. Issue is joined. Discovery may begin 30 days after the last responsive pleading is filed, right? So if a reply is required, it's going to be 30 days after the reply is filed. If there is no reply required, it'll be 30 days after the answer is filed. But the important rule to know is that no discovery may be begun until that 30-day period expires. Regarding pleading special matters, there are specific rules that require a party to set forth in the party's pleadings any matters constituting an avoidance of an affirmative defense. So anytime, and we talked about res judicata, it basically means that if the issue has already been decided, then that special matter needs to be already pled. And that term, the thing has already been decided, or the issue has already been decided, is known as res judicata. Right, it's that issue that the taxpayer, that specific taxpayer is raising, has already been decided. There, same is true for collateral estoppel, which we've talked about previously. Estoppel, waiver, duress, fraud, and the statute of limitations argument. A mere denial in a responsive pleading is not sufficient to raise that issue. So it's got to be affirmatively pled any of those specific matters. So the question you might get on an exam is, the IRS intends to raise collateral estoppel, right? Taxpayer is criminally convicted under, let's say, Section 7206(1), right, of tax evasion, whatever it might be. The IRS now wants to rely on collateral estoppel, but did not plead collateral estoppel in the answer. What is the effect of failing to plead collateral estoppel? It's not in the case, right? A mere denial in a response of pleading in the answer is not sufficient to raise the defense of collateral estoppel. So hopefully that makes sense. It might seem like a foreign concept. I think if you look through the materials, you'll get more comfortable with it. It's important to remember that anytime the IRS raises a new matter in the answer, it has the burden of proof. Let's just talk about amended pleadings. This is another area that the tax court likes to test. Think about what the purpose of the tax court is, right? It's supposed to be a taxpayer-friendly forum, right? The purpose of the rules we talked about last class is to secure the just, speedy, right, and fair determination of every single case that's before it. And as we also talked about, right, these rules are crazy, right, that you have to comply with to file a petition, right? So you're so focused on following the rules, that you might miss a material fact in your case, or the case might have come to you last minute. You might not have remembered what to put into your, or known what to put into your petition. The rules allow for those situations, right, through amended pleadings, and parties should not be hurt by, let's say, a practitioner's failure to plead a specific element in a pleading. So a party may sometimes want to amend their pleadings. During the process of discovery, they might learn additional information. During the course of getting to know their client, they might learn additional information. There are two ways that a party can amend a pleading, right? First is a matter of course. Anytime before a responsive pleading is filed, so before the answer is filed, or before, let's say, an answer is filed, or a reply is filed for the IRS, as a matter of right, a party may amend its pleadings. So 30 days, matter of right, you don't need to request leave of court, right? You don't need to ask the court's permission. Any other time, right, once the responsive pleading has been filed, and for 30 days thereafter, you have to get what is known as leave of court, which is essentially permission of the court. So if you think about the way that this works in procedurally, right, taxpayer files two documents. First is what is known as a motion for leave to amend the pleadings, right, or motion for leave to file an amended pleading. The second document is actually lodged, right? It's given to the court, but the court doesn't file it until the court actually gives leave to file it. That document is lodged, and that is the amended pleading, the amended petition, or the amended answer. So two documents that are typically, that are always filed, a motion for leave to amend the pleadings, and then you're gonna lodge the related amended pleading. And what you'll see when you look at a lot of these decisions that come out of the court, the reported orders, is that the court is going through and doing a straight balancing test, right? If justice requires that the court grant leave to file the amended pleading, they say that, and then they go ahead and they do two things. They grant the motion, and they direct the clerk of the court to file the document, right? Documents that are not filed are not part of the record, right? That's why it's important, as you're going through this process, to make sure that you have, that your documents that you're submitting to the court are part of the actual record. So just keep that in mind. We're running a little short on time. Let's just talk, all right, so we talked about the general rule, and this is an interesting issue that may come up, is amendments to conform the pleadings to evidence. There are times, okay, where you will forget to plead a fact in your petition. You will forget to make a claim in your petition. Or there will come times when your client, for the first time on the stand, gets honest and starts telling you certain matters that you had no idea existed at the time you were filing the petition. You can actually make a motion, so long as it's not an objection, right? An aware counsel, somebody who's actually an aware opposing counsel, has actually gone through and read the pleadings, will actually know what is in the pleadings and what is not. And to the extent that you try and introduce evidence that is inconsistent with the pleadings, that party should make an objection, right? It's outside the basis of the case. It's been deemed conceded. They've already waived it, right? If you're dealing with someone who's kind of asleep at the wheel, you can actually get things in through evidence. Okay, have the witness testify to it, and then make a motion after the testimony is already in evidence to conform the pleadings to the evidence. So that way your pleadings will mimic whatever we came out at trial, whatever additional items came out at trial. These are typically arise in the case of issues tried by consent, right? So let's say that in connection with the notice of deficiency, the IRS determines that the taxpayer had $5,000 in unreported interest income, right? And let's say there is no allegation in the pleading saying that that was an error, right? Normally under Rule 34, that issue would be deemed conceded, all right? But now you're gonna go ahead and you're at trial, right? Fast forward now, 12 months later, you're actually at trial, got your witness on the stand, and you say to your witness, you start asking him questions about his bank account and the interest he gained from therefrom. So that wasn't actually my bank account, I was just a custodian or a nominee of that account for somebody else. Well, now you've just put that interest income in play, right? But you shouldn't be allowed to because you didn't raise it in the petition. Your ability to do it, right, if your opposing counsel is asleep at the wheel, is through these issues tried by consent, right, through a motion to conform the pleadings to evidence. So general rule, if it's not in the pleadings, it is not in the case. This is really the only exception to the rule, all right? I think we're probably just running out of time, so let's just talk about parties real quick. I'm gonna jump to, I think, slide 252, so just bear with me a second when we get there. We're gonna take a break in probably just about 2 minutes. These are the questions that we covered last week, for those of you who are wondering what I'm scrolling through. We didn't cover all the necessarily wanted to. So in this part of tax court procedure and practice, we'll be talking about parties, motions, trials, ADR, right, alternative dispute resolution, the decisions, opinions, and rules, the five computations of the court, appeals decisions, how to file an appeal, what it means to take an appeal, claims for costs and fees, and sanctions, and section 6673 penalties. So just real quick with respect to parties, right? We talked already about deficiency cases. In a deficiency case, the case must be brought by and in the name of the person against whom the commissioner, the IRS, determined the deficiency, right? Or by and with the full descriptive name of the fiduciary entitled to institute a case on behalf of that person. Generally, the proper party before the court is the party named in the pleading, in the notice, the operative notice. The only real exception to that, right, is if you have someone that has passed away, and now you have somebody else, an authorized fiduciary, somebody who is authorized under state law to come in and prosecute that case on behalf of the otherwise proper party. We talked about when a party has capacity. A party must have capacity in order to maintain a legal proceeding either on behalf of oneself or on behalf of someone else. You have to be of age, right, is really the only real requirement. You have to be, I don't think you need to be competent, right? You just need to be of age. And capacity is determined by the law of one's domicile, right? So it's a state law determination. Capacity is always a question of state law, not of federal law. Right? Some of the problems that come up with respect to capacity that you should keep an eye out for your exam. If you see anything when you're dealing with corporations, right, or infants, or people who have been declared, you know, a ward of the state, or have had somebody else appointed a guardian of them, estates, trusts, and other interested parties, those are situations where you might not have the proper party present before the court. You do, right? The question is, all right, well, we don't want to dismiss the case, right? Because the goal is to keep the live controversy live. But we do want to make sure that we have someone who is authorized under state law to actually prosecute that case. And we talk about Nordstrom cases and the Nordstrom case and Nordstrom orders, I believe, in the materials. It's kind of outside of the scope of what we're trying to do today. But just keep in mind that the proper party must be before the court. When you're dealing with situations so when you don't have the proper party before the court, how does the court resolve that? They deal with it by way of what is known as a ratification. So a timely case brought by the wrong party is not going to be dismissed. Why? Because the court wants to preserve the controversy. What the court will do is allow a reasonable time for the proper party to ratify the petition, which is basically an affirmation saying, I've read the petition, I agree to all the contents in it, and I want to prosecute the case this way, right? That's the ratification. To the extent that the proper party disagrees with what is already in the petition, then the proper party, once they're in the case, will file an amended petition or an amended pleading, right, to get his or her views into the case and his or her position into the case. All right, I think this is a good point to take a break, and when you guys come back, we will pick up on motions.
These evaluations, right, to the extent that there's anything that you guys, you know, want us to do in terms of other courses or any suggestions on how to make it better, put it in the evaluation. Two, we're going to have a course on New Jersey collections. That's not going to be on the exam. You've seen it, but a lot of you have been asking questions or emailing me about, you know, New Jersey. They've gotten very aggressive in collecting. So on October 27th, we're going to have a class just dealing with the Division of Taxation, the state of New Jersey, on New Jersey collection issues. We've got Luke Cabero from New Jersey coming to explain, you know, the collection alternatives, the procedures in New Jersey, and we're trying to get somebody from Pioneer to also come and explain, you know, what can you negotiate with Pioneer, what are the limits of their authority, and how to deal with New Jersey having gotten very active. That's not for the tax credit exam, that's just for responding to the emails on, are you gonna cover New Jersey collection? Yes, October 27th, thanks.
Have you never really had any experience in a courtroom? You might be wondering, what is a motion? Is a motion is an application to the court for a specific order within the confines of an existing case. It is the means by which practitioners ask the court for different procedural or substantive relief or to correct a case procedurally. So many times during the course of a case, you might be dealing with situations where either the opposing party has run afoul of a rule, or you've run afoul of a rule, or even the court has run afoul of a rule. You can request relief from the court by filing a motion with the court. Let's talk about some terminology, because it's going to come up on your exam and it's going to come up when you're actually practicing. So the terminology actually matters. When you're dealing with motions, the moving party, and these are going to be in your rules, is known as the person who makes the motion, and that person is called a moving party. The non-moving party is the other party, right? The party who is not making the motion. Typically, it's the party who's opposing the motion, but it can also be the party who doesn't object to the motion. Generally, the non-moving party is known as either the non-moving party, the opposing party, or an answering party. So when you're reading your rules, you're going to see these terms, and you might be wondering what they are. This is what they are. Generally, in response to a motion, the court orders a response. So when you actually get orders from the court, it's going to say, you know, on January 3rd of 2016, petitioner filed, let's say, a motion to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. The respondent, the IRS, shall file a response within 45 days or 30 days. The response to the motion is what is known as a response. The response to the response is actually what the courts refer to as a reply. You can go on ad nauseum. You have sir replies, which is a reply to the reply. You have sir replies, which are replies to the reply, or reply to the sir reply, and so on and so forth. So sometimes you'll see this terminology either in the opinions you're dealing with and that you're reading, and that's really what they're getting at. You might also see the word used sua sponte. Sua sponte is Latin. It means on its own, right? The court on its own is taking a certain action. It is not necessarily in response to a motion. It might be granting certain relief. You might also see documents known as orders to show cause. So typically, we're going to talk about discovery. When you're dealing with situations where one party is not doing what they are required to do under the tax court rules, the court may issue an order to show cause, which is really an elevated order which carries with it a particular sanction, or may carry with it a particular sanction. Typically, that sanction is having matters deemed admitted or getting hit with financial costs or an inability to present evidence on that point. But an order to show cause is basically directing the party to explain to the court why the court shouldn't take a particular action. When the courts resolve of an order to show cause, not many people know this, there's really three things that the courts can do. Either the courts can discharge the order to show cause, meaning that they're not going to take any action. They can make absolute the order to show cause, which is they are going to take exactly the action that is threatened in the order to show cause, i.e. The penalty or the sanction that's being imposed. Or they can discharge in part and make absolute in part, which is basically that they're going to grant some of the relief, so they're going to require the taxpayer to produce, let's say, documents 1 through 5, but they're going to discharge the order to show cause in all the other respects. So they are not going to require the taxpayer to produce documents 6 through 10. All right? The importance of motion practice, really, I mean, this is the bread and butter for anybody in tax court. Effective motion practice can be used to not only expedite the handling and disposition of cases, it can also be used to help narrow issues, improve the pleadings, eliminate the necessity to prove certain facts, and secure substantial procedural advantages for your client, substantive advantages for your client. So motion practice, the importance of it really can't be understated. The tax court rules generally require that motions be separately stated, which means that each motion may address only one matter. When you file a motion, you should say, Your Honor, I have a whole bunch of things that I messed up on, and I want you to fix all of it with one order. Right? Not only do I want you to amend the pleadings, I also want you to direct the government to answer my interrogatories, and I also want to shift the burden of proof to the IRS. Right? That would be improper joinder of motions. What you want to do is you want to file a separate motion for each relief being requested. So here are the reasons that I should be entitled to amend my pleadings. Here is the basis for it. Here's the legal support for it. Please grant the relief requested. Here's the reason that my motion should be granted to force the IRS to answer my interrogatories, my discovery questions, specific reasons that it should be granted. Generally, the court rules break it up and sort of the materials. We're not going to run through every single type of motion because literally, I mean, there are hundreds of types of motions that you can file. But the way that I think about motions is you have motions with respect to the parties and motions with respect to the pleadings and motions with respect to jurisdiction. Right, these are going to be your motions that come at the really, really early onset of your case, for the most part. Second, you're going to have motions that deal with respect to discovery. Third, you'll have pretrial motions. Next, you'll have post-trial motions. And finally, you'll have miscellaneous motions. Despite what you may think, in tax court, there actually aren't very many motions made at the trial. The general rule within the tax court is to have all motions in writing. There are a couple of exceptions to that, but the general rule is to have all motions in writing, and all motions must state with particularity the reasons for the relief requested and the specific relief being requested. I'm just going to talk real quickly. Motions with respect to the parties, the pleadings, and jurisdiction. We're going to talk about the motion to dismiss and the motion to amend pleadings, because those are kind of, I think, the most important. Motions with respect to discovery, we'll talk about the motion to compel discovery, and the motions to compel stipulation, and we'll talk about that during the discovery process. With respect to selected pretrial motions, we'll talk about the motion for summary judgment or the motion for partial summary judgment. With respect to motions or select post-trial motions, we'll talk about the motion for reconsideration and the motion to vacate or set aside a decision. And the reason that we're focusing on these items is these are the areas, A, that are most important to a practitioner's practice area, but also it's the area that the tax court tends to test most frequently. So filing a motion with the court, let's talk about the general requirements. We talked about the fact that a motion must generally be in writing and must contain the following items. It must state with particularity the grounds for filing the motion. It must set forth the relief or other order being sought, and it must show that prior notice is given to the opposing counsel. And it must state whether that opposing counsel objects to the the relief being granted. The thought is, right, in most courts, you file what is known as a consent motion, which is all the parties consent to the relief being requested. Right? In tax court, for whatever reason, the tax court doesn't allow you to file a consent motion. It requires you to file a motion and to state with particularity whether the opposing party objects or does not object to the particular motion. The only real exception to the requirement that motions be in writing is that motions made during a hearing or trial generally need not be in writing unless the court directs otherwise. So you might have situations where an attorney moves to strike certain testimony. That doesn't need to be in writing. But almost all of your other motions, I would say overwhelmingly probably 95%, 98% of your motions are going to be in writing. All of those rules that we talked about in the last class concerning the caption, right, being required on every motion, the signatures actually being required, and the effect of a signature, right? Not only that you are proving that that document is your own, but you are agreeing really to the veracity of, or at least the good faith basis for the argument set forth in the motion. And the number of copies, right? Generally, we have one for each docket number that we're filing, although we're generally going to file electronically, unless we're filing at a calendar call. If you're filing at a calendar call and you're going to give paper motions to the court, you want to keep one motion or one copy of every for every single document if you have a series of documents in the case. We talked about the effect of the signature. So the signature of counsel or party constitutes a certification by the signer that he or she has read the motion and that to the best of his or her knowledge, the motion is well-grounded in fact and is warranted by either existing law or a good faith argument for the extension, modification, or reversal of existing law. So the next question is, all right, after you file the motion, what does the court do with the motion? Hopefully the court deliberates and considers the items contained in your motion. But generally the court is going to do a couple of things in the course of that deliberation. What we generally find, right, is that the judges are going to review it, and then they might decide that they want to hear additional information from either the counsel or in writing or orally. So courts may dispose of a motion in a number of different ways. First, they might direct a response. So let's say it's taxpayer's motion, IRS is directed to file a response, and then the court might take an action. For instance, the motion for leave to file an amended pleading is granted, and the court is directed to file the answer as of the date of this order. Right? Or the motion to exclude, let's say, certain expert testimony at trial is granted, and the opposing party is precluded from actually presenting expert witness, right? I think I spoke to you all about expert testimony. The court can also direct a hearing and take particular action. So the court might set the motion for generally what we would think of as oral argument, right, where the court wants to hear from the counsel as to the basis for their arguments in addition to whatever's set forth in writing, and then it might take an actual course of action. The location for that hearing can really be at the court's convenience. We all know, right, that the court is a court of national jurisdiction, so it can hear cases all over the country, but generally also its judges are based in Washington, D.C. So many times the judges might want to have the hearing set in Washington, D.C. If you've got counsel coming in from all over the country, or if all counsel is located locally, many judges are willing to actually go up so that the taxpayers and the government don't have to bear the additional expense of having all their attorneys attend these hearings. The court can also take an action without a response. It might say, yeah, you know, I've looked at the documents, there's no objection from the opposing party, and it seems pretty reasonable, the relief being requested, so I'm going to go ahead and grant the relief requested anyway. Yes?
Can a case that's docketed, say, in New York, at the judge's behest, be moved for a particular hearing in Washington or something to that effect?
Absolutely for a hearing, yes. The judges definitely have the discretion to set the hearings wherever is convenient for them. So I have seen, for instance, judges, even though you've got a trial team of, let's say, seven lawyers in California, or let's say seven private bar lawyers in Los Angeles, and let's say you've got local counsel in Los Angeles also assigned, the court still could direct everybody to come to Washington, D.C. Most judges are not going to do that, right? They don't want to do that to the taxpayers. They'll make the trip out to Los Angeles. But in situations where, let's say, you've got a designated place of trial in New York, and for whatever reason, the taxpayers selected Chicago, Illinois as its place of trial, I've seen judges actually hold the parties to say, I don't care that you're both in New York. You set place of trial in Chicago. I'm going to be in Chicago, and I want you to come to me. I'm not going to come to you. It really varies, but generally, I think overwhelmingly, the judges really try to be somewhat accommodating to parties and to try and be cost-effective. Motions are generally not a grounds for postponement of trial, right? The general view is that, well, I'll just wait till the 60th day or the 30th day and I'll file a motion. And the court's going to continue the case because they have to decide the motion. Most judges are going to say, you've known about trial for 6 months. I don't care that you filed a motion. We've got, this case is set for trial. I'll decide the motion after I've taken all the evidence. So the general rule is filing a motion is not a postponement of trial. That also includes situations where you're dealing with new counsel coming in. New counsel coming in, and I think we've talked about it, and if we haven't, you should know it, but new counsel coming in is not grounds for a continuance. I think the court has tested that a few times in the past. The court rules on its motions by issuing written orders, right? Some of you are reading the designated orders that the tax court issues every day, and this is very similar to what most other courts do. Orders are generally not treated as precedent, right? Except this may be relevant to establish the law of the case, right? To show that something's already been litigated and already decided, right? Res judicata, the thing has been decided, or other similar doctrines. We talked about res judicata, so I think we covered that, but let's just run through it again because I think it's a foreign concept to some. Res judicata is a legal rule that a final judgment on the merits by a court of competent jurisdiction is conclusive between the parties, right? So we have to have the same parties. If the taxpayer loses in tax court, right, the taxpayer can't then pay a refund and then come and sue for a refund in district court. There's res judicata, it's already been decided. So for example, if the tax court decides the taxpayer's liability for a given year, both the taxpayer and the IRS are precluded from reopening that year under the doctrine of res judicata. So it cuts both ways, right? The IRS, once they've gone through and they've litigated the case, if there's an issue, I mean, you know, barring fraud, the IRS can't come in and reopen that year. Collateral estoppel is a legal rule that precludes relitigation of any issues or fact or law that was actually litigated and determined by a valid and final judgment. So the thought, right, is what you're really looking for in situations of collateral estoppel. You have situations where the parties are in what is known as privity, right? They're almost in agreement with respect to their legal position. We think of like the Department of Justice and the Internal Revenue Service, right, as being in privity with one another because they are both representing the interests of the governments. So if you have a situation where a taxpayer is criminally convicted under Section 7201 for tax evasion, right, he or she is going to be precluded from coming in and now saying that he or she didn't have fraudulent intent when the IRS now tries to collect a civil fraud penalty from the taxpayer. And so collateral estoppel is it's a really foreign concept, but that is the situation where it most typically arises. Res judicata, you've got same parties, same issue already been decided. Collateral estoppel, you have same elements, same offense, right? Same interest of different parties coming in and the tax court essentially barring the taxpayer from doing it. Most typically, we see collateral estoppel come up in the situation of civil trials following criminal convictions, right? The other interesting case that was decided, Judge Halpern just recently decided this case. This was a division opinion of the court. The government came in, so taxpayer was criminally convicted, agreed to, let's say, tax restitution of $200,000 in connection with that criminal conviction, right? The IRS came in and said, no. The taxpayer is not allowed to challenge the $200 restitution award, right? In connection with the criminal conviction or now in connection with the civil case because the taxpayer is collaterally estopped from doing so, right? Parties in privity with one another, right? And here the U.S. Attorney's Office of the Department of Justice and on the other side of the IRS coming in to argue. And the IRS wanted to say, no. One court of competent jurisdiction has already determined the amount that the taxpayer owes, the amount of the tax loss in connection with that tax evasion conviction. And what Judge Halpern actually said is, yeah, collateral estoppel might apply to fix the state of mind, but it doesn't apply to fix the amount of the tax loss. So the taxpayer can come in a subsequent case, even though they criminally plead to a higher number and argue in the tax court case that the number is something else. All right, but there's got to be a basis for it. There needs to be some reasoning behind it. All right. So that, I think, is an area that might be ripe for testing. When we're talking about motions with respect to the parties, the pleadings, and jurisdiction, the first place we typically go is to the motion to dismiss. So a case may be dismissed for cause upon a motion of a party or upon the court's own initiative. court dismisses a case by entering, right, as opposed to filing or mailing. They actually enter it, right? Somebody sits there with a stamp and stamps it in order of dismissal. A motion to dismiss challenges the legal adequacy of the petition, right? There are various types of motion to dismiss. You can have, the most typical ones are a motion to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. So the court is not empowered to hear this case. You might have a motion to dismiss for failure to state a claim, which is a situation where, look, court, even if we granted, even if we bought into everything that the taxpayer has in their petition, there is still no relief that can be granted, right? Because the notice of deficiency is correct, or the taxpayer failed to give any or request any relief. You might also have situations where you have a motion to dismiss for failure to prosecute. So where the taxpayer fails to prosecute his or her case, and they fail to move the ball along, right? If you go to, for those of you who have been coming to the calendar call hearings, you'll hear a lot of motions to dismiss for failure to prosecute, right? The IRS is implementing discovery. They're requesting discovery. Taxpayers ignoring them, right? The IRS is filing motions, right? The court is directing responses. Taxpayer doesn't file a response. At trial, if the taxpayer doesn't show up for trial, the government files a motion to dismiss for failure to prosecute. So let's talk about motions to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. We talked about the fact that if a court's jurisdiction is called into question, if you're going to do it, if you're going to call into question the court's jurisdiction, you do so through a motion to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. The court typically will order a response before acting on a motion to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. If the court grants the motion, as we mentioned, it does so through granting an order of dismissal. Motion to dismiss for failure to state a claim. Whenever it's appropriate to grant a motion to dismiss for failure to state a claim, the court will, again, issue an order of dismissal, enter an order of dismissal. You're dealing with situations for failure to state a claim where even if we took all the allegations in the petition to be true, that there is no relief that can actually be granted to the taxpayer. Motion to amend the pleadings. This is an important one. We talked about the fact that a party may amend the pleading once as a matter of course, right? Anytime before a response to the pleading is filed, or if the case hasn't been calendared for trial, anytime within 30 days after it is served. The only other way that the court will allow an amendment to a pleading is if the taxpayer files a motion for leave to amend the pleadings and request that the court actually grant the filing of the amended pleading. We talked about the procedure previously for filing the motion to amend the pleadings. This is an important point, and this is what is this appropriate standard for amendments. The rules specifically require that leave to amend shall be freely given when justice so requires. This is a really, really low threshold, and the court has granted motions to amend not only before trial, it's actually done so at trial and even after trial. So we've had situations where we've actually tried the case and amended pleadings were getting filed after the trial had already occurred. Whether justice requires that the court allow an amendment to a pleading is really determined by looking at all of the facts and all of the circumstances leading to the need to amend the petition. Among the factors that the courts may typically examine is the timeliness of the motion for leave to amend, the reasons for the delay, whether the moving party had sufficient prior opportunity to allege the matters. So let's say that a taxpayer was represented pro se and then counsel came in after the fact. The court might say, look, the attainment of new counsel is grounds because that counsel is seeing things that a pro se petitioner might not otherwise see. And the last point is whether the opposing party would suffer surprise, substantial disadvantage, or prejudice if the motion to amend were granted. So typically when you're dealing with situations when the IRS has commenced all this discovery and it's already prepared for trial, if you have a taxpayer who comes in very, very last minute on the eve of trial and tries to amend its pleadings, the court might say, right, it's going to balance all these factors, but the court might say, and we find that the prejudice to the government, in conducting discovery for 3 years and the taxpayer not amending the petition to include these additional allegations outweighs, any interest the taxpayer actually has in making these additional arguments. So it's a balancing test, right? Which means that it might be a good question on your exam for purposes of writing to see how well you understand the principles. So I think they've asked about motions to amend, and you should definitely be familiar with, amendments to pleadings. Let's talk real quickly about motions with respect to discovery and discovery generally. Generally, we have a party that refuses to engage in discovery, right? We know that under the general rules regarding discovery that the courts favor informal discovery. Right, that's set forth right in Rule 70 of the tax court rules. Right, the general rule is the tax court rules require informal discovery on the basis of a case by the name of Brannerton, Brannerton Corporation versus Commissioner. And the general rule is that formal discovery is kind of an afterthought, right? We don't go right to formal discovery. And the reason that this is so novel of an idea is that in every other court, you proceed specifically to formal discovery, right? I mean, you slam your other party with request for admission, you slam your other party, or you do have initial information exchanges up front, but for the most part, parties exchange documents and information by way of formal discovery. The tax court is very different. Once you get to a point that you've actually gone into formal discovery, it's fine, I mean, it's provided for in the rules. But if you're dealing with a party who refuses to engage in discovery or to stipulate as required under the rules, the opposing party might file what is known as a motion to compel. So court, please compel the party to act. And if the party doesn't act, impose sanctions on that party, right? And those sanctions can be anything. They can be monetary sanctions. They can be prejudicial to the client. The client shall not be allowed to introduce the type of evidence, you know, being sought through the discovery proceeding. Motions to compel must be filed, if at all, no later than 45 days prior to trial. So it's important that you engage in your discovery beforehand and that you file your motion to compel well before that 45th day. For purposes of your exam, you need to know that motions to compel must be filed 45 days before trial. We're going to talk about discovery real quick. There's a bunch of different discovery devices available in tax court. I want to talk about really two primarily, and I'll note the third. First, taxpayers can engage in interrogatories, and the IRS can engage in interrogatories, which is basically one party asking questions of another party who is obligated to answer those questions, right? Second is a request for production of documents, where one party is asking the other party to produce documents relevant to the case. The third case, right, the third type of discovery are depositions. And depositions really are very, very limited in the tax court. Situations where you might have depositions if you're dealing with a sophisticated large business and international client, or if you're dealing with a situation where you have a witness who might die or is terminal, you might want to perpetuate his or her testimony vis-a-vis a deposition. But for purposes of what I think you all need to know, just familiarize yourself with the general rules for depositions, which we'll cover and which are included in the materials. But let's talk about interrogatories. We know that interrogatories may be used as a discovery device, and any party may serve, right, without asking the court for any permission whatsoever, 25 interrogatories on another party. The tax court has broad discretion to grant leave to a party to serve additional interrogatories. So if you're dealing with situations where you've got a complicated case and you say, there's no way I can ask everything I need to ask in 25 parts, right, you might ask the court for leave to allow you to serve up to, let's say, 100 or 150 interrogatories. And it all depends, right, on the specific needs of the case. The general rule that you need to understand is that interrogatories are generally permitted, and that generally one party can serve on the other party 25 interrogatories, right, without leave of court, without asking the court. Those interrogatories are not filed with the court. Generally, the courts do not want to be involved with discovery. They don't want to be involved with discovery disputes between the parties. They don't want to be involved with resolving discovery disputes between the parties, right? The thought is that everybody are professionals, you're all members of the same bar, and that everybody should be kind of conducting themselves as such, and you know, with a view towards discovering the truth, and in a way that is most advantageous to your client. Interrogatories must be answered within 30 days of service, unless the court allows an alternate timeline. Each interrogatory must be answered in good faith, and the answers must be as complete as the answering party's information permits. The interrogatories and responses need not be filed with the court, absent a motion with respect to an objection or other failure to answer an interrogatory.
Can a party subpoena another party to the court?
Yes, of course. So the question for those of you at home is whether, one party can subpoena a party. And there are a variety of subpoenas that you can actually issue. The two most common are a subpoena, right, which is a subpoena usually to appear to testify. And we'll talk about subpoenas. They're covered by Rule 147 of the rules. But courts can also, or parties can also issue subpoena ducis tecum. So a subpoena with documents is how it translates to literally. And basically what you'll see is subpoena ducis tecum usually directs a custodian of records, typically in a tax case, a bank, right, or a financial institution or a business to produce certain documents. Just in the interest of answering your question fully, the subpoenas are enforceable. Generally, they're enforceable at the calendar call. You can make them enforceable at the calendar call. So that way you don't get it last minute, right? We talked about last class, kind of the lay of the land and how cases set up, right? You know, that we have the calendar call on day one, that the trial might not occur, you know, until later in that week or even possibly the next week. So what you often want to do when your case is set for a calendar, right, anytime you're requesting documents from a party, make your subpoenas returnable on the date of the calendar call, even if your trial is set for a different date, right? The whole reason is the reason that you're issuing the subpoena to Dukas Tecum is because you want the documents, right? Not necessarily that, and you and the opposing party will most likely stipulate to whatever is in those documents. To the extent that you don't have the foundation or the parties are not in agreement that those documents are, you know, should be stipulated, you should also subpoena the witness to be able to lay the foundation to have those evidence, those documents admitted. All right?
I mean, in a case, you're typically this is what the parties are, typically the petitioner and the respondent. Who else could be a party?
Yeah, no, that's, well, the other party you could have is an intervener in an innocent spouse case.
Those are the only situations, or, I mean,
if you're dealing with a partner other than the tax matters partner, so a notice partner, you might have multiple notice partners. All right? But those are really the only situations where you're going to have discovery. And just so you understand, I mean, an intervener is given the same status as a party in these proceedings. So if you have interrogatory requests that you, an intervener is the person that is opposing the relief for innocent spouse request, you can serve interrogatories on that person. You can serve requests for admissions on that person. That intervener is obligated to comply with all of the other requirements regarding stipulations and admissions and discovery.
So you would not be able to serve an interrogatory on, say, a partner in a partnership who is not a party to this at all?
No.
Although he may be associated in some way with that.
Yeah, exactly. All right, time and manner, we talked about that. Motion to compel allowed. If a party refuses to respond to interrogatories, party may move to have the opposing party respond to the interrogatory. That's the motion to compel. We talked about the fact that it must be filed within 45 days of trial. The second type of discovery that we talked about are requests for production of documents. And those are covered by Rule 72 of the Tax Court Rules of Procedure. A party may, without leave of court, serve on another party a request to produce, right? And there's everything that's listed on here, but it's basically any written document or electronically stored information imaginable, right? Letters, memorandum, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? Think about what the limits to these are. These limits are gonna be really threefold. Either one, it's gonna be, you're not gonna be able to reach attorney-client privilege information. Two, you're not gonna be able to reach work product privilege information. And three, you're not gonna be able to reach the information which, let's say, your client spent a lot of money to produce, and it would be unfair for your client to now have to produce that information for the other side. It's what is known as the unfairness doctrine. In addition, I mean, when you're dealing with situations where you have real property valuations in question, the IRS can actually also request entry onto lands in order to value the property in connection with the case and have the IRS's appraiser value those materials. Generally, a party must respond to a request for production of documents, electronically stored information, and other things within 30 days of the service of request, unless the court allows an alternate timeline. Generally, 30 days to respond. The response is required to state as to each item or category that inspection and related activities will be permitted as requested, unless the request is objected to, in which case the reason for objection shall be stated. Right, so if you're objecting based on privilege, right, that it's attorney-client privilege or practitioner-client privilege, work product privilege, you would be required to produce a privilege log. You wouldn't produce the document, but you'd state a log that says, yeah, I do have these other documents which are technically responsive to your request, but I'm not producing them for, you know, because they are attorney-client privilege, for instance. Again, neither the request nor the response needs to be filed with the court, absent a motion to compel production of the document. So when you're dealing with situations, we have a motion to compel getting filed. The court will sometimes also direct that a response be provided to the court. And it really varies on the judge as to what their choice is, but the general rule is you don't file discovery with the courts. The exception, and we'll talk about it, is for admissions. Let's talk about some of the kind of exceptions to production of documents and expert reports. Draft expert reports, right, are prepared in advance of litigation are generally not discoverable. And for those of you who took the class on experts that we offer, we talked about some of these rules. If a party refuses to produce documents in accordance with the tax court rules, a party may move, have the opposing party produce those documents under Rule 70A. In addition, you might be dealing with situations, another device that is available to help narrow the issues for trial are what is known as admissions. So it is a request by one party to another party, asking that that other party admit certain things, right, that are not reasonably in dispute. So a party may serve on another party a written request for the admission for purposes of pending action of the truth of any matter which are not privileged and which are relevant to the subject matter involved in the case, but only if the matters are set forth in the request and relate to statements or opinions of fact or the application of law to fact. Think about what that means is if one party takes the position that there is a fact not reasonably at issue, he or she should state that fact, right, in clear and straightforward terms, and you know, as well as all the other facts and the points of law that he or she contends are not reasonably in dispute, and send those over to the other party, right, pursuant to Rule 90A, and ask the other party to admit to those items. The reason that you do that is because a matter admitted or deemed admitted is conclusively established unless the court, right, upon the motion of a party, allows a withdrawal or a modification of the admission. So we talked last time about when you can be relieved of motions, when you can be relieved of admissions. The general rule, right, is you're going to go ahead, you're going to make, file your request for admissions, you're going to serve them on the other party, you're going to file a copy with the court. The other party generally has 30 days to respond to those admissions, either admit, deny, right, or it's a conclusion of law to which we cannot admit or deny or something along those lines. But it's generally admit and deny. If the matter is deemed admitted, okay, it's going to be deemed established for purposes of the case, and there's no reason to offer evidence of it at trial. So you can significantly shorten the number of issues and time needed for trial. We talked about when a request for admissions can be made. We know that generally we have to wait until 30 days after joinder of issues, so after the answer and the reply have been filed. Generally, a party has 30 days to respond to the request for admissions, or each matter is deemed admitted. And requests for admissions must be completed no later than 45 days before trial. So think about what the court's doing. It wants all discovery motions completed and filed. So it really wants all discovery completed within 45 days of trial. And if you think about it, it really needs to be completed before then, so that way you can file your motions to compel. To the extent that a party is not happy with the other party's answers, so many times when you're doing a request for admission, you might include documents, right, to try and show the other party that the requested admission is not reasonably in dispute. To the extent that the opposing party sometimes will refuse to admit whatever you're asking them to admit, as many taxpayers do, as some IRS counsel do, as many interveners will do, you can file a motion with the court to review the sufficiency of answers or to request objections to the admissions. So the party who has requested the admissions may move to determine the sufficiency of the answers or the objections. Generally, in response to a motion to review the sufficiency, the court will typically order a response to the motion to review. Unless the court determines that an objection is justified, it shall order an answer that an answer be served. If the court determines that an answer does not comply with the requirements of Rule 90, then it may order either that the matter is admitted or that an amended answer be served. An amended request for admission is served. The court may also, so think about what the general rule is. We said that we file a request for admissions with the court and matters not specifically denied or deemed admitted, right, if they're not denied within 30 days. So you might have situations where either an unknowing taxpayer or an asleep at the wheel IRS counsel accidentally has admissions admitted against him or her. And that might have been an error, right? It might have been a procedural error, it might have been some type of other error. You can actually request the party who has had the matters deemed admitted against them can request leave of the court to actually withdraw or modify the deemed admissions. To say, Your Honor, it was an oversight on the part of counsel. We didn't intend to actually deem admit all of these items. We would ask for an additional opportunity to withdraw the admissions and respond to them specifically. And generally what you find is so long as it's sufficiently far in advance of trial that it didn't affect the other party's discovery, the court will grant that motion to withdraw the deemed admissions But to the extent that you're getting close up on trial and parties are modifying their discovery approach as a result of these deemed admissions, the courts are going to be less inclined to grant the relief requested. Let's talk about motions to compel stipulation. Tax Court Rule 91A requires the parties, and this is a really, really unique feature of the tax court that is not common to other courts. The tax court requires the parties to enter into what are known as stipulations, which is essentially an agreement, right, as to all matters, not privileged, which are relevant to the pending case, regardless of whether the matters involve fact or opinion or the application of law to fact. The purpose of the court, right, we talked about last time, is to secure the just, speedy, and fair resolution of all these cases. Stipulations help the courts narrow the issues for trial. So Rule 91A requires the parties to stipulate all matters which are not reasonably in dispute. The matters don't even need to be relevant to the case, and they can really relate to anything. The parties can and do actually reserve objections, but the general rule is that the parties must stipulate to anything to which an unqualified agreement can be reached. So that's the general rule. The court generally describes stipulations as, quote, the bedrock of tax court practice. So it's a really, really important part of tax court practice and procedure that the court emphasizes. To the extent you're dealing with situations where a party refuses to stipulate or fails to confer with opposing counsel with respect to entering into a stipulation, or if they refuse to make a stipulation altogether, the party proposing to stipulate may file with the court a motion to compel stipulation. And that motion to compel stipulation says, Your Honor, here's what we want the opposing party to stipulate to. Here's why we want them to stipulate to it. Please direct them to stipulate to it. And the court will actually direct a response from the other party, and there's very, very specific rules about what actually has to be included in the motion and in the response. But to the extent that the court deems that these matters should be stipulated, the court will actually deem them stipulated. So sometimes when you're reading these opinions, you'll see kind of in the first introductory paragraph, right before the court says where the taxpayer resided, it says that the parties have stipulated certain matters, and other matters were deemed stipulated, right, pursuant to Rule 91E. Those matters deemed stipulated is because the parties couldn't reach agreement with respect to the stipulation process, and the court forced one of the parties to actually stipulate, to agree to the items set forth in that proposed stipulation. Yeah.
Is there a difference between a motion to compel admission and a motion to compel stipulation?
Yeah, the question for those people at home is there a difference between motion to compel an admission and a motion to compel stipulation? There is a difference, but they are functionally the equivalent. You are forcing one party to admit or deny, right, which is really all you're doing is you're saying, when you're doing a motion to review the sufficiency of admissions, right, you're saying that chalkboard is white, and that party is saying it's China white, right? And they're refusing to stipulate that it's white because they're taking just a different view for whatever it is. You can have the court review the sufficiency and say, all right, court, take a look at the board. Is that white or is it China white? And the court can either say, yeah, you know what, it is white, and the other party should agree to it. When you're dealing with a motion to compel stipulation, it's a little bit different. You're saying, here is a full allegation or a full statement, or here is a particular document, and we want the parties to stipulate to that particular item. It's subtle, but there is a difference. One is a motion to review the sufficiency, one is a motion to actually force the party to agree. Right? And what the court says in the motion to review is they look at it and they say, you know, we think the board is white, you know, consider your answer. That's really the big thing. I don't know if that makes sense, but that's the way I think about it. It's a slight but subtle difference. Generally, if you're dealing with a situation where you have a motion to compel stipulation, the party proposing to stipulate must make a motion to compel stipulation no later than 45 days before trial. Right? Stipulations are, they're not considered discovery, but they're considered a very, very close cousin of discovery. With respect to the motion to compel stipulation, these requirements are set forth in the rules. The motion to compel stipulation must, again, show with particularity and by separately numbered paragraphs each matter which is claimed for stipulation. It must set forth in express language the specific stipulation which the party proposes with respect to each matter and attach thereto copies of the requests, actually requesting the stipulation. It must set forth the source reasons and basis claiming with respect to each matter that it should be stipulated. And the motion to compel stipulation should show that the opposing counsel was given an opportunity and had reasonable access to those sources and basis for information for the stipulated information, excuse me. So, generally, it must state with particularity all of the items that you're requesting for stipulation. The easiest way to do that is to actually prepare what I would refer to as a draft stipulation of facts, which is going to be what I propose the other party to enter into, to send that and attach that as an exhibit, and refer the court to that or incorporate it in my motion to state these additional items. The court typically grants a motion to compel. It's almost automatic, right? They don't actually issue a response. Instead, what they do, if you look at the court rules, they grant the motion to compel and they issue an order to show cause. And it says, all right, we take the stipulation process so seriously that we are automatically going to grant it, and we're going to elevate the sanction to the point of an order to show cause, that you now need to explain to us, right, why these matters shouldn't be deemed stipulated. The order to show cause will be served by the clerk of the court and a copy sent to the moving party, right? According to the rules, right, and the court, the judges, some judges have a different preference, but generally within 20 days of service of that order to show cause, the party to whom the order is directed must file a response with the court showing why the matters set forth in the motion papers should not be deemed admitted for purposes of the case. The response must list each matter involved on which there is no dispute, specifically referring to the numbered paragraphs in the motion to which the admission relates. It must show each part of a proffered stipulation for which there is agreement and for which there is a challenge, and it must show the sources, reasons, and basis on which the responding party relies as a basis for the objection. Generally, if I'm dealing with a situation, I don't usually deal with opposing counsel, right? Usually, the IRS tends to be pretty reasonable in what they're doing, and we can generally reach agreement with respect to a majority of the requested stipulations. So rather than inundate the court by saying, you know, well, there's agreement with respect to paragraphs 1, 3, 7, you know, it's just going to create confusion. I do two separate documents, right? Whatever I and the IRS actually agree to goes into one document. We execute that document. Whatever we don't agree to, I include in a separate document, and I file that as a motion to compel the IRS with the tax court. And then I wait for the IRS, the court, to issue an order to show cause, and for the IRS's response to see why those matters shouldn't be deemed stipulated. In response to the non-moving party's response, right, the court is going to take certain steps with respect to that order to show cause. And we talked about either they're going to make absolute the order to show cause, right, which is to say, all right, all matters that the party is requesting be stipulated are now deemed stipulated for purpose of the case. They're making pure, right, their threat under the order to show cause. Or they're going to discharge, right, and they're going to say, no, the opposing party has a reasonable basis for refusing to stipulate. We discharge our order to show cause. We don't enforce any sanctions against the non-moving party. Or, as is often the case, the court is going to take almost like a Solomon-like approach and say, well, we'll require the non-moving party to stipulate to, let's say, matters, you know, paragraphs 1, 2, and 3, but not 4, 5, and 6. So they might do a partial. But the general rule is the courts don't want to be involved in this. The parties should be able to reach, you know, agreement amongst themselves, reserving objections along the way. There's nothing wrong with observing objections. You actually have to reserve objections in the stipulation. So some of the objections you might raise during the stipulation process might be relevant. You know, if you're dealing with tax year 2009, but the taxpayer wants to produce information about 2007, you know, it's not really relevant. What went on in 2007 usually isn't relevant to what went on in 2009, because each year stands on its own. And that's typically going to be the IRS's response. There might be some way that the IRS is going to, that the taxpayer might draw a distinction, right, in a connection between 07 and 09. Typically what the IRS will do is they'll stipulate it, right, that this occurred in 2007. They're going to say we reserve an objection because it's not relevant to the instant case. If you have a situation where a response is not filed with the court in response to a motion to compel stipulation, then the matter will generally be deemed stipulated for purposes of the pending case. So generally when you're dealing with, let's say, more advanced counsel, they will immediately file a motion to compel stipulation, because why not? You conferred with the other party, or you tried to confer with the other party. The rules require the parties to stipulate and to reach unqualified agreement, and if you're not willing to do it, file the motion. Why? Because if you don't respond to the motion, those matters are all deemed admitted anyway. And it really is your obligation as a practitioner to do it. Many times when you're seeing, when you see these orders to show cause come out of the court, you also see that the court also threatens sanctions under Rule 104. Rule 104 allows the court to impose sanctions for a variety of different things, including excluding any evidence that is actually covered by the stipulation, imposing monetary sanctions, or altogether dismissing a case. So you don't want to be in a situation where sanctions are imposed against you. Make a good faith, reasonable effort, A, to stipulate, and B, to state your objections as to why you're not stipulating. All right, after a motion to compel and any responses related thereto are filed, as mentioned, the court is going to take certain actions with respect to the pending motion. Let's talk real quickly about pretrial motions. A motion for summary judgment, right, is one type of motion that can be filed that attempts to bring to a head all the legal merits of the case or the part of the case, right, on the basis of the pleadings, the affidavits, and the exhibits, right, without a trial. In many of these cases that we're dealing with, trials are a waste of time, because even if everything that the taxpayer was saying was true, right, there is legal support for, let's say, the IRS's position, or the opposite may be true, that even if every allegation taken by the IRS in the notice of deficiency was true, right, the taxpayer would be without relief because, for example, the statute of limitations has already expired. So anytime you have situations where you have a legal issue in dispute, you can bring that legal issue to a head by filing a motion for summary judgment. Summary judgment is a procedure that is designed to avoid those unnecessary trials that we just talked about. Either party can file a motion for summary judgment, either in full or in part. It's important to note, the court has been harping on this, that anytime a party files a motion for summary judgment, that motion for summary judgment really needs to be supported by a declaration or an affidavit, right? A declaration, all documents filed with these courts have to be filed under statement of penalty of perjury, under 28 U.S.C. 1746, right? But the general and I think most important thing to note is that the court has been really frustrated with people and practitioners not filing supporting declarations, basically relying on allegations and motions and treating those as facts. And those allegations and motions are generally unavered, right? They're not generally sworn to, in front of either a notary public under a penalty of perjury, which is why the court tends to distrust them. So it's real important. I wouldn't be surprised at all if you see one of those questions on your exam where you've got a motion for partial summary judgment filed and there is no supporting declaration. What exactly should the court be doing? And the short answer is probably giving no weight or limited weight to the unavert allegations in the motion for summary judgment. And probably direct the parties to file a declaration, like deny the motion without prejudice. A motion for summary judgment may be filed at any time commencing 30 days after the pleadings are closed, right? So when issue is joined, and no later than 60 days before trial, right? The thought is that if you're trying to dispose of a major issue in a case, right, either the entire case or a major issue in the case, that the motion for summary judgment has to be filed within 60 days before the case is actually calendared for trial, set to come up for trial. The court does have discretion to allow the filing of a motion for summary judgment after the 60-day deadline. Generally, what they'll do is they will take the motion under advisement, go ahead, have a trial on all the issues, and then decide the motion for summary judgment in connection with the resolution of the case. So kind of the takeaway for you all to note for motions for summary judgment, they are required to be filed no later than 60 days before trial, and they must be supported with declarations or affidavits and any other documents that the moving party, right, the person filing the motion for summary judgment is relying on. The court will always order a written response in response to a motion for summary judgment. After the motion and the response are filed, the court usually renders, it will render a decision, right, as compared to an order, right? A decision is actually disposing of a discrete legal issue in the case or the entire case. If, quote, the pleadings, answers to interrogatories, depositions, admissions, and any other acceptable materials, together with the affidavits and declarations, if any, show that there is no genuine dispute as to any material fact and that a decision may be rendered as a matter of law, right? The threshold standard for a motion for summary judgment is that a decision must be able to be issued as a matter of law. There can be no genuine disputes of material fact at issue. In addition to full partial summary judgment, which disposes of all of the case, you can also have situations where you have partial summary judgment allowed. A motion for partial summary judgment may be filed with respect to one, more than one, or all issues presented in the case. Anytime you're dealing with factual inferences in response to a motion for summary judgment, either full or partial, all facts and all inferences drawn from those facts are going to be viewed in the light most favorable to the non-moving party. So if the record's not clear, right, for whatever reason, then we infer always that the record would otherwise be in the light most favorable to the person that's not making the motion. But at the same time, we don't want to simply allow the non-moving party to just rest on his or her allegations. In response, like a motion for partial summary judgment, right, is a really extraordinary step. One party is coming forward to the court and saying, Your Honor, there's nothing at issue here. You can decide this case as a matter of law right now, because even if you took everything that the petitioner claims to be true as true, he or she is still not entitled to relief. So the non-moving party actually has to come forward and set forth specific facts showing that there is an actual genuine dispute for trial. All right, so how do you do that? Right? Normally you set forth your own declarations and your own affidavits to say, well, the IRS's position, right, is inconsistent with what my position would be at trial. And here are three witnesses, and here's what they would tell you at trial. And here's why it makes my case worth hearing. And that's really the ultimate point of resisting a motion for summary judgment.
Is a summary judgment decision appealable?
The decision to grant, the question is, for those of you at home, is whether the summary judgment decision is appealable. Yes and no. Yes, you can absolutely appeal it, and the grant or denial of a summary judgment motion can be appealed in connection with the appeal of the case. The reason I say it's somewhat true is because let's say you have a motion for partial summary judgment, and let's say the court grants that motion for partial summary judgment, and it lets everything else go to trial, right? If you think about situations where you've got charitable contribution deductions, and you have, let's say, the court coming in and saying, well, the taxpayer didn't comply with the substantiation requirements, right? So the decision is going to go against the taxpayer, and a motion for partial summary judgment will be granted in favor of the IRS, but it's only partial because the court still has to decide the question of value, right? To determine whether there is, let's say, a substantial valuation misstatement penalty or a gross valuation misstatement penalty. Some taxpayers might request what is known as an interlocutory appeal, right, in which the court makes a decision that really affects the future outcome of the rest of the case. So a party can technically request an interlocutory appeal immediately when the motion for summary judgment is filed. That interlocutory appeal will be denied 99.99% of the times. Generally, the court would force everything to trial, have all the evidence come in, and then on the appeal, right, the person who lost the motion for summary judgment would say that the court made a mistake in granting the motion for summary judgment. You can also argue on appeal that the court made an error in not granting a motion for summary judgment, but I think you'll find that appellate courts have really, really broad discretion, or give broad discretion to trial courts to determine when a fact is at issue. And if you've got a court that is not willing to grant the motion for summary judgment and forcing a case to trial, it's much less likely that that case will get overturned on appeal. Yeah.
From a practical standpoint, is there an opportunity to request that the tax court on bank consider this summary judgment issue, again, with regard to a matter of lawsuit?
Right. The question for those of you at home is whether you can request what is known in an appellate court as en banc review or full court review, is what I would refer to it as in the tax court. You can request anything you want in a motion. I have seen numerous motions, Frank has filed numerous motions where he has requested review of the court to review a particular motion. That request, I won't say is always denied, right? It's often denied. The situation where you would have a court-reviewed opinion is in a really, really extraordinary case, right? Where you've got an invalidation of a regulation, you have an overturning of existing law, you have some extraordinary step being taken is when you would get all 19 judges to sit down and to confer on whatever it is at issue in your motion. So yes, you can request it, unless you've really, really got a novel issue, don't expect that it would be granted. Let's just talk real quick about post-trial motions, and then we'll give you all your second break. There are a number of post-trial motions that can be made. The most typical are a motion for reconsideration, which is my particular favorite one today because I had an adverse decision on one today. So a motion, either party may move the court to reconsider an opinion or a finding of fact. So we talked before, and we're going to talk about later on, that the way that the court expresses its reasoning, right, is through an opinion. And to the extent that one party is not happy with the tax court's opinion for one of many reasons, either they don't like the ultimate result, or they don't like the reasoning, or the reasoning wasn't complete, they can request a motion to reconsider that opinion. Now, you've already had a judge, right? Think about what you're doing in the context of a motion for reconsideration. You've already had a judge go through, pour over the entire record, right? And now you're asking him or her to admit that he or she was wrong the first time around, right? To do it. So they're probably granted, you know, one out of 50 motions that you're filing, a motion for reconsideration will actually be granted. So it's very rare because, you know, the thought is the ground that you're typically setting forth in a motion for reconsideration is some other legal theory that, quite frankly, you didn't make eloquently enough or that the court didn't buy the first time around. So the motion for reconsideration must be filed, if at all, within 30 days after the written opinion has been served, or within 30 days after the bench opinion is issued, right, which is usually 30 to 60 days after the actual trial. Reconsideration under Rule 61 is intended to correct substantial factual errors or legal errors. It is also intended to allow for the introduction of newly discovered evidence, right, that the moving party could not have introduced in the prior proceeding by the exercise of due diligence. The courts generally have broad discretion as to whether or not to grant a motion for reconsideration. The courts typically do not exercise granting that, exercising that discretion, excuse me, absent of showing of unusual circumstances or substantial error on the part of the court. The court is very clear that reconsideration is not the forum for rehashing previously rejected legal arguments or tendering new legal theories to reach the end desired result by the moving party. Right, so the thought is that your pleadings and your brief should be as comprehensive as possible, and if they're not, a motion for reconsideration is not a ground to test that in a legal theory. You might get a situation in which, you know, taxpayer waived an argument at trial, and then they come in and file a motion for reconsideration on the ground that they didn't do their job the first time around. So what then should the court do? And I think the short answer is probably that the court should deny the motion for reconsideration, and the taxpayer can take an appeal to see if they actually waive the issue or not. So that's just to give you an example of how it might go up in practice. Motion to vacate or set aside decision is the second and final post-trial motion we'll talk about and let you guys break the second break. After, right, we talked about there's two documents filed after, most typically, right, anytime you've got a reported opinion, there is one, a reported opinion or a report that sets forth the court's reasoning, and two, the actual decision, right, which gives operative legal effect to the opinion. We talked about the motion of reconsideration, right, which takes care of the opinion. You can also file a motion to vacate or to revise a particular decision, and either party may move to vacate or revise a decision with or without a new trial. Generally, the motion to vacate or revise a decision must be filed within 30 days after the decision has been entered, unless the court otherwise permits. In no event may a decision be vacated or set aside once it has become final, for example, 90 days, unless the notice of appeal has been filed. So general rule is if you're gonna request that the court vacate a particular decision, right, you don't agree that decision should have been entered against petitioner, you don't agree that jurisdiction, the court should have been dismissed for lack of jurisdiction, but the court entered, right, its decision, you can move the court to vacate it, right? Or if a decision was entered on the basis of fraud, right? The IRS might come in and say, yeah, we agreed to this number, but we had no idea, you know, the taxpayer fraudulently hid whatever it might be. The IRS might come in and try and ask the court to vacate the decision and to stipulate a decision on this ground, the grounds of fraud. Generally, right, any post-trial relief, it's gotta be filed within 30 days. The exception to that, right, is that you can't take any additional after 90 days. Why? Because after 90 days, that decision has become final, an appeal hasn't been filed. Generally, motions to vacate, like motions to reconsider, are a very, very extraordinary measure. It generally will not be granted absent unusual circumstances, such as mistake, inadvertence, surprise, excusable neglect. The court does have broad discretion, but they very, very rarely exercise that discretion. And with that said, I think it's probably a pretty appropriate time to take a break. When you come back, we'll talk about settlement offers and qualifications. The offer must be designated as a qualified offer under Section 7430, and the offer must remain open from the date it is made until the earlier of either 1, the date the offer is rejected, 2, the date the trial begins, or 3rd, the 90th day after the offer is made. Let's just talk real quick. We're going to run through a bunch of different areas that could potentially be tested in connection with the tax court exam. Just note for you before we do that, that anytime a taxpayer makes a qualified offer that the IRS rejects, and if the taxpayer later wins a determination to pay less than the amount offered, the taxpayer would be considered a prevailing party and potentially entitled to costs. So I mentioned that if you reach an impasse in negotiations with the IRS, if you're looking for a way to kind of move the ball toward settlement, consider making a qualified offer to try and resolve the case, you know, based on what you think, a dollar less than what you think you can actually do at trial. And generally, qualified offers are going to get elevated up the chain of command, and they will get reviewed by folks who tend to be more senior and maybe perhaps a little bit more mature about getting past that impasse to get a case settled. Yeah, question.
Okay, my question actually is, as a petitioner, when you make a qualified offer, is it when you know that, okay, it's like this, I don't really have a good case here, and you know, you want to make an offer to the opposing party, IRS, that okay, I'm offering this amount. Is it from both ends, is it the IRS who make a qualified offer, or the petitioner that makes the qualified offer,
right,
or either party?
So the question is, I'll just summarize it. When do you make a qualified offer? I think is part one. Part two is whether the IRS can make a qualified offer. And part three is what do you do if you have a really, really weak case, should you be making a qualified offer? First, only the taxpayer can make a qualified offer, right? Because the IRS generally isn't going to be entitled to fees in connection with litigation. And even if they are, right, they're not going to be entitled to fees under Section 7430. They would be entitled to fees under most likely Section 6673, right, which we're going to talk about later on, but basically imposes sanctions for frivolous positions taken at trial, or what the statute refers to as vexatiously multiplying the proceedings, so taking really, really unreasonable positions and forcing the IRS to incur a whole bunch of litigation costs. So we tend to see the taxpayers only file them, and the taxpayers only can file them. Would I make a qualified offer if I have poor facts in a case? And I think that this also goes in hand with your first question, which is when do you make a qualified offer? I make a qualified offer when I think I can make a pretty reasonable argument to resolve the case, and the facts aren't horrendous to me. So if I'm dealing with a situation where I have, let's say, a valuation, and I know what the proffered value of a particular item is, I might offer $1 less or $10 or $100 less than whatever number my appraiser is coming out to. If I have really bad facts, like a substantiation case, and Mary knows this, if my facts are horrific, right, I'm not gonna make a qualified offer, because at that point I really am bidding against myself, right? I'm looking at, let's say that if I go to trial, right, and the best I can do at trial is 20%, that would mean that I'd have to offer somewhere in the range of like 19%, right? But I don't want to get 19% in a case, right? I want to get like 80% settling in a case, right? I want it 80% in my favor. So sometimes I think that I can actually do better by having a conversation with opposing counsel and putting the documents in a way that is kind of most, advantageous for my client in the light most favorable to him or her. It all depends, but I think that you're going to reach a point many times that you'll be at an impasse, in the settlement offer process, and the qualified offer will get that senior person, right, which is many times what you want, right? A lot of the times your docket attorneys and your litigation attorneys are kind of the bulldogs in the ring, and you kind of need a more senior person sometimes to step in and say, hey guys, let's take a little perspective and really evaluate what our hazards of litigation are. It's a way to get them. Okay. Pre-trial conferences, real quickly, Tax Court Rule 110 allows for the parties to request and the court to hold pre-trial conferences. The court can hold pre-trial conferences on basically anything that it wants to do. Typically to check on the status of a case, to narrow the issues for trial, to force the parties to stipulate or work on the parties to stipulate, or to otherwise assist in the preparation of trial or the disposition of the case without a trial. Calendar cases. If a case is calendared for trial, either party may request that the court, either party may request that the court may sua sponte hold a pretrial conference. The court has broad discretion, obviously, as to whether, when, and where to schedule a pretrial conference. If you have a case that is not calendared for trial, either party also can request that the chief judge or the chief judge may sua sponte order a pretrial conference. Typically, the pretrial conference is going to be held in Washington, D.C. So when you have these typically large business international cases, if they're not yet calendared for trial, the parties might still request that the case be assigned, and that the parties know that there's going to be so much discovery in the case, that the discovery alone is going to take years, that they might want to get started as early as possible. We're going to talk about trials, but let's talk about alternatives to trial real quickly. The tax court rules have a number of rules that actually allow for trials with, or decisions without trial. Those are set forth in rules 120 through 124. Trials obviously are not always advisable. They tend to be very expensive. You can generally request four different alternatives to trial. First is a judgment on the pleadings. Second is summary judgment, which we talked about. Third is submission without trial, decision without trial under Rule 122. And finally is alternative dispute resolution under Rule 124. We talked about judgment on the pleadings real quick. A judgment on the pleadings is a judgment based solely on the allegations and information contained in the pleadings and not any outside matter, right? So this is, when we're talking about motions, this is the view where the court says, look, court, even if you take everything that is alleged to be true, alleged in the petition to be true, it doesn't matter because the taxpayer is still not entitled to relief, right? In those situations, that's when you might expect to see a motion for a judgment on the pleadings or for the court to actually enter a decision on the pleadings. We talked about how it's obtained. It's obtained by filing actually a motion. It's not necessary to run through the example. Summary judgment, I think we covered summary judgment pretty in detail. Just make sure that there's nothing else that we need to cover. There's not. Just again, remember that motions for summary judgment need to be filed 60 days before trial. And generally, the non-moving party may not simply rest on the allegations and denials in the party's pleadings. Instead, the non-moving party has to set forth specific facts showing that there is a genuine issue for trial. Submission without trial. This is something y'all should be familiar with because this is something that's unique to the tax court. Tax Court Rule 122 allows the parties to file a joint motion to submit their case for a decision without trial. Right, so typically this is when this situation arises, when you have the parties in full agreement on all the facts to be presented to the court, but the parties disagree as to how the law should apply. You could file a motion for summary judgment, but for whatever reason you don't hit that 60-day deadline, both parties agree and say rather than file cross motions for summary judgment, we'll just submit the case on the basis of the stipulated record, and the court renders a decision on the basis of the stipulated facts in the parties' briefs. So a joint motion for submission without trial can be filed any time after the joinder of issues in lieu of trial. The burden of proof, it's important to remember that if you submit a case for decision without trial under Rule 122, that doesn't alter the burden of proof. So the burden of proof is still on the taxpayer to prove by a preponderance of evidence that the IRS's determinations are wrong and that the taxpayer's computations or the taxpayer's position is correct. If a party fails to plead as provided in the court's rules, then the defaulting party may also be held in default by the other party. And so that might be a situation where a reply is due and no reply is filed, or briefs are ordered to be filed and no briefs are actually filed. The court may determine that a party is in default and may thereafter enter a decision against the defaulting party. Anytime you're dealing with a situation where you're talking about default, this is important maybe to know for your exam, The court may also award sanctions against the defaulting party. So generally, if there's, you know, a failure to prosecute, a failure to respond to the court's order, sanctions might be appropriate because it was considered pretty much a waste of the court's and the IRS's time. We talked about dismissal. A case may be dismissed for a failure to properly prosecute his case, his or her case. It can also be dismissed for any one of a number of reasons that we already talked about: lack of jurisdiction, failure to state a claim, any of those other different issues. Let's talk about, so we covered alternatives to trial. Let's just cover one other area, that's alternative dispute resolution. The tax court rules have adopted different areas of alternative dispute resolution in order to get the parties to try and amicably resolve issues without intensive or voluminous document cases. The parties can file a motion requesting arbitration anytime after a case that is issued. Request for arbitration is made under Rule 124A. The parties must attach to any motion for voluntary binding arbitration a stipulation executed by each party that sets forth specific items that are set forth in 124A2. It's basically an agreement to be bound and how this specific particular arbitration will take place. The parties can also submit for voluntary non-binding arbitration to have the case assigned to a judge or a special trial judge. And that judge or special trial judge is assigned broad latitude to direct the mediation in any matter that the court deems appropriate. Again, just running through the rules. These are things the tax court tests from time to time, but they really are a little bit limited. Excuse me. Regarding calendars, if a hearing is to be held on a motion or other matter other than a motion related to a trial, then the hearing may be held on a motion calendar in DC or at any other location that the court determines. It's important to know that the court will generally not engage in ex parte communications, which means that both parties must be present before the court will engage in a conversation with either one party. The court may hear a matter ex parte. The exception to Rule 130A is found in 130B, and the court may hear a matter ex parte if a party fails to appear at a hearing held on a motion or other matter. Right, so if you're required to appear and don't, the court can still talk with the other party. Each case, when an issue, will be placed upon a calendar for trial. We talked about this, right? You remember there was like a yellow timeline that we had talked about in the last case, and we talked about trial calendars and the course and the life cycle of a tax court case. This deals with trial calendars. Just so you all understand, generally a case is calendared for trial, right? 5 months ahead of schedule, the court sets the case to be called at a particular calendar call when the court is traveling around the country. And then at that calendar call, the court will assign that particular case for a trial during either that week or the following week. To the extent that additional time is needed, then the court may hold special trial sessions, something to that effect. The court conducts, as I mentioned, regular trial sessions, which is basically as they're traveling around the country, these are amounts in dispute that are greater than $50,000. The court also holds small tax case calendar sessions. These deal with cases that have $50,000 or less, and also special trial sessions that don't come up on the regular cycle of the tax court calendar, but which the court may still set for a trial, typically because the trial is going to last, you know, over the course of more than a week, where there's not enough time in a particular designated session to actually hear that case. That's all pretty straightforward. It's important to know standing pretrial orders under Tax Court Rule 131B. The court typically issues, right, 5 months before trial, they're going to issue one, a notice setting the case for trial, and two, a standing pretrial order. It's really important that you all read the standing pretrial order and pay attention to the deadlines in there. The purpose of the standing pretrial order is to facilitate the orderly and efficient disposition of a case. Most typically, the standing pretrial order will establish a number of deadlines, including when any discovery cutoff dates are due, when motions to file pretrial memorandums are due, if you have a final status report, when to submit it, and other things that the court wants. One thing you should keep in mind, the standing pretrial order also requires that certificates of service, right, a certification that the document was served upon the opposing party be included with all documents. And that's somewhat inconsistent in the inconsistency in the court rule because the court rules, or at least the electronic filing rules, provide that if a party is registered for electronic filing, that you don't have to give a certificate of service. Now the IRS has all of its attorneys engaged in registering e-filing, and all practitioners are required to e-file. So as between counsel, really, the certificate of service isn't necessary, but under the rules of technical, or under the standing pretrial order, it still technically is. Let's talk about different ways to deal with getting a case set for trial. To the extent, let's say that you're a few months out from trial, you know when your case is going to be called at a particular calendar trial, and say you don't want to have to go to the calendar trial to wait for your case to get called at some point in time later on that week. You can file a motion for a date and time certain. So the parties can request a date and time certain for trial by filing a motion with the court. The benefit of doing so is to avoid having to appear for the calendar call to obtain a trial date and time. We also talked about special trial sessions. Right? This is a calendar of one or a few cases. Special trial sessions can last as short as one day or as long as the trial is needed. Right? There have been some trials that have lasted 5-6 weeks, and some maybe even more than that. It all depends upon the case, the issues presented, and the number of witnesses to be called. Let's talk about continuances, because this is an area that the tax court has historically tested as well. Many courts allow what are known as adjournments, right? That is the name used in most courts. The tax court, permits what are known as continuances. So a case or matter scheduled on a calendar may be continued by the court, either on its own, sua sponte, or upon a motion of the party. A motion to continue shall always inform the court as to the other party's view with respect thereto, right? That we already spoke about, that's required for all motions. A motion to continue based upon the pendency in court of a related case or case shall state the name and docket number of the related case, the names of counsel for the parties in such case, and shall identify all issues common to any related case. The important thing, I think, to take away with continuances is that they will be granted in only exceptional circumstances. Right, conflicting engagements of counsel or employment of new counsel are ordinarily not regarded as grounds for continuance, and that's something that the tax court has requested previously. That a taxpayer files a motion for continuance 15 days before trial because the taxpayer hired new counsel. How should the court rule? Well, the first thing to remember is that simply hiring new counsel is not grounds to grant the motion to continue. But more importantly, any motion to continue filed within 30 days of trial is generally going to be regarded as, quote, dilatory, as a delay tactic on the part of the filing party, and will generally be denied unless the ground for the motion arose, when there was not good reason for not making the motion sooner. All right, let's talk about trials real quick. I think we do an entire class on trials separately, so we could probably get through this relatively quickly. There are two operative sets of rules, right? And you guys have covered both sets of rules at this point that will govern a tax court case at trial. First, the tax court rules of practice and procedure, which we spoke about last weekend tonight, and the federal rules of evidence, which Jeremy Klausner spoke to you for two nights as well. We had already discussed the federal rules of evidence. We're gonna talk about the general rules for tax trials, and it's important to remember that these general rules may be modified for small tax cases. And we'll spend a few minutes on small tax cases right at the end of tonight's session. But it's important to note just some general rules. At the time a petition is filed, right? We talked about the petition being filed. We talked about the statement of taxpayer identification being required. We also spoke about requesting a place of trial when the petition is filed. You designate your place of trial at the time the petition is filed. That's pursuant to Rule 140A. The IRS may designate a place of trial if the taxpayer does not designate it. Generally, when that happens, the IRS tends to pick a place of trial that is pretty close or the closest to the taxpayer's place of residence. If a party desires to change a place of trial, he or she may do so. The party must file a motion to that effect stating the reasons therefor. If the motion is filed after the case has been set for trial, the motion will generally be denied. It will generally be deemed as a delay tactic. Consolidation and separation of cases. The court may order a joint hearing or trial when multiple cases involve a common common set of issues or a common set of laws, right? So you might have situations where you've got let's say, 155 different taxpayers, all of whom have the exact same issue with the exact same fact pattern, because, for example, it was a tax shelter promoted by the same promoter using the same type of entity over and over again. Of course, the courts in those types of cases may wish to consolidate those cases or to issue a series of test cases to go forward rather than having the court have to hear all 150 cases. Other situations where you might be dealing with consolidation is if you have multiple years. You might have a taxpayer that has, let's say, a collection case that concerns 2009 and a deficiency case that concerns, let's say, 2010. The court might just simply consolidate all of those cases because even though 9 and 10 are separate years, you know, the taxpayer is the same, the issues are the same, the income, the job, everything is the same. So the court, in many events, may consolidate cases to the extent that holding all cases together would confuse the judge, right? Those situations, if all 150 trials actually went forward, right, that might be confusing to try and get through that much evidence. The judge can actually order consolidation or separation of the cases. Let's talk real quickly about burden of proof. We know that taxpayers generally have the burden of proof in tax court, right? Taxpayers must prove the deficiency determination is wrong in order to prevail. The IRS generally bears the burden of proof with respect to any new matter, any increase in deficiency, or any affirmative defense pleaded in the answer. The IRS also bears the burden of proving fraud by clear and convincing evidence. We're going to talk about shifting the burden of proof to the IRS, but before we do that, I just want to note the IRS also has the burden of production, right, with respect to penalties. There are two really different burdens within the tax court, and I think the tax court has previously tested on this, right? The burden of proof consists of the burden of persuasion, right, which is the burden of proving that the weight of the evidence favors one party or another. But the burden of proof also consists of a burden of production, which is the burden of coming forward with evidence. All right, so we say that the IRS bears the burden of production, that it is appropriate to impose a penalty, which means that the IRS must come forward with evidence to show that the taxpayer engaged in some type of misconduct to support the imposition of the penalty. And that's specifically set forth in Section 7491C of the Internal Revenue Code, and in a case by the name of Higby. So it's important to understand the differences, really, between the burden of proof, the burden of production, and the burden of persuasion. It's just helpful to understand the burden of proof consists of, one, the burden of production, and two, the burden of persuasion. And I think that has been previously tested. there are situations where the burden of proof may actually shift to the commissioner of the IRS. Under Section 7491, that section provides that the burden of proof in any court proceeding, so not just tax court proceedings, but also district court proceedings, may shift to the IRS if a taxpayer introduces credible evidence with respect to any factual issue relevant to ascertaining the taxpayer's liability. Think about kind of that anomalous result, right? We say the burden of proof is going to shift to the taxpayer, but who's got the burden of production? It's the taxpayer. The taxpayer's got to come forward first with information to show that it's appropriate, right, for the remaining burden of proof, the burden of persuasion, to shift to the IRS. Regarding transferee liability, which has been tested increasingly over the course, which we think is going to be tested increasingly, there have been a number of cases that have come out on transferee liability. The commissioner generally has the burden to prove that the taxpayer is liable as a transferee, but not to show that the taxpayer was actually liable for the tax, right? So there's a different theory of going after an individual as opposed to actually owning the tax. There's separate rules regarding accumulated earnings taxes.
How does conflicts get resolved? So say typically in a doctrine of constructive receipt case where the IRS says you did receive income, we're going to issue a CP 2000, you're going to challenge it, say you didn't, you go to court, the IRS still maintains you got the income. How do you prove you didn't get it?
How do you
where's the burden of proof there?
How do you prove the negative?
Yes.
I mean, that's the great question. That's a good question, right? The question for people at home is, how do you prove the negative? How do you prove that a taxpayer didn't receive the income that the IRS is claiming that they do? All right. There's a couple of things to know. Anytime you're dealing with unreported income, right, that first burden is actually on the IRS to come forward with evidence linking the taxpayer to the income-producing activity. So that what the IRS will do, right, is what they should do is force the parties to stipulate to, let's say, Form 1099, right, showing that the income was paid, or Form W-2, showing that the income was paid, right? Then what you would do, right, once that information is either in evidence or the parties refuse to stipulate it, the IRS is then going to have to answer additional questions. So in your case, where you have like unreported income, how do you challenge it? You challenge it by putting the taxpayer on, right, to say, I never got that income. The bank account doesn't belong to me. I didn't work at that job during that year. That's not my Social Security number. Yeah, that's my Social Security number, but it must have been stolen because I never worked at, you know, five different places. It's really just a question of strategy in terms of how to attack it. And the way that it comes up is that the IRS has that initial burden of coming forward with the evidence. And when the IRS starts putting on that evidence is when you're really going to challenge it. But I think what you'll find is that if you've got a 1099 issued, the IRS is going to try and get the taxpayer to stipulate the Form 1099 or that underlying information return to establish its initial burden. And then under Section 6201D, you can establish to show that that the connection was, you know, not there yet.
I have a circumstance where a CFO of a company acknowledged on penalties of perjury in an affidavit that there was a computer program problem with the W-2 and the waitress did not make $90,000, but it was $900.
Okay, so one of the questions was, I guess there was a computer glitch program within a restaurant company, and you actually put on the CFO to say that there was a computer glitch company that...
An affidavit
that was putting on multiple zeros. What I will generally tell you is that affidavits the courts tend not to rely on, right? The courts generally prefer live in-court testimony. The IRS might prefer it and might, you know, be willing to stipulate it, but generally if the courts can't, they don't like the affidavits. But to prove the negative is not easy. But the burdens, I think, you know, do kind of work out to protect the taxpayer, and then it's incumbent upon you really to bring out the truth as to why the IRS's allegations are not true. If the IRS is claiming that the person worked, I don't know, the hair salon, and that person has no hair salon technique, then put that person on the stand to say, I never worked at the hair salon.
Yeah. In that case, wouldn't it be easier for the company to reverse the error with the IRS?
It would certainly be easier if the companies were willing to do that or if it would bind the IRS. So the question for people at home is if it's easier to go to the company to try and get them to reverse the information reporting. You can go to them and you can threaten sanctions against them under Section 7434, and you can do all sorts of different things to try and get a company to react. Where you have companies erroneously classifying employees, right? I've actually had the exact opposite of what most of you have had, where I'm in a case now where I have a company that erroneously classified a client as an employee as opposed to an independent contractor, right? And the reason that they're doing it is because that person works in a particular industry where there is a lot of misclassification. So they just classify everybody as employees, but they're not making any substantive actual determination. So the question then is, what do you do? I went to the company, and I asked them to reverse the determination and say, can you move everything from the W-2 onto a 1099? So that way, I can then rely on the 1099 in court. And you know what my response was? Their response to me was, oh, we'll have to talk to legal and get back to you. And nobody ever gets back to you, right? So what do? You respond to them again, and then they don't take your call. And then you start leaving messages saying, don't return my calls, we're going to issue a subpoena very shortly for you, right? And then you get a call back from legal, and they say, we'll look into it. And nobody ever calls back. So what do? You subpoena them. Right? You subpoena them. But that's where we are. Sometimes you get companies, right? I've had larger brokerage houses. I know we're almost out of time. I've had larger brokerage houses where they've screwed up in issuing 1099s, right? Serial 1099s. So I had people that were rolling over IRAs, right? Well within the 60-day deadline to actually roll over the IRA. And it wasn't, I won't mention them, but it was multiple financial institutions, very, very large brokerage houses that were not checking the appropriate boxes to indicate that it was a qualified rollover. And I have clients who are getting notices that they owe a couple of $100,000 in tax. They don't owe it, right? It was a qualified rollover, right? And the person, I said, what did you do? I mean, you know these rules. And he said, I did what I was supposed to do. And in those situations, actually, both brokerage houses corrected the 1099s.
But they just...
So,
This is an EA question. They went to the lawyer instead of the EA to fix it?
I don't know.
Now, I'm not trying to be rude or anything, but why would someone go to an attorney when we have the power to change it? Yes, I'm
depends on what it's
I don't. I guess it depends on the client. Right.
He's got an E2, so don't.
Yeah, we got an E2. The question is, why did they go to an EA? I don't know. I mean, in the one case, it's because we're already in tax court, right? And that's what you're going to be doing soon, so they can go to the EA. Right? And then on the other case, it's just been a long-term client that I know for a very, very long time. So. All right. Where are we? We talked about ex parte statements. All right, we talked about depositions. I'm sorry, we're kind of just running through things. All right. They were recent. Oh, okay. So we talked about expert witnesses and expert witness reports, right? And we talked about the recent amendments to those rules that now change the requirements. And you guys don't even know the old rules at this point, probably, because you know the new rules so well. So we're just going to skip over them. We've covered expert materials so much. All right, let's talk about subpoenas because this is important. We talked about, yes?
When you said amended, it's not, when was it amended? Because our white books, whatever you want to call it, come to the tax court, they didn't put the new amendments up at this point.
They should be. I mean, to answer your question, they were amended in July of 2012, but they were amended a few years after Federal Civil Procedure 26 was amended. Okay. If you don't have the amended versions, just go to their website, and the website's pretty good.
No, I know it is, but when you, because I call tax court, it stated, let's say, 2012. For goodness sakes, why can't you have just upgraded and just put 2016 on the bottom so we know it's the last
one? Yeah. When you get admitted, you can.
You're going to sell that number to tax court or something, they're going to take my number and make sure I fail.
Yeah, I don't know. It's the way that I think about this stuff is this is their rules in their court, right? And I'm a guest, so. All right, we talked about expert witnesses. Let's see what else. Mike, what are we at, like 5 minutes left?
Yeah.
Let's take a break. Oh, we're almost there. We're getting there. All right, I was going to talk about, we spoke about subpoenas, right? So we talked about the two different types of subpoenas. You can have a subpoena to command attendance at a trial, and you can also have a subpoena to produce documents, a subpoena duties taken. This is important to know, right? They might ask you about the rules for issuing subpoenas because a lot of people have no idea how to do it, right? Like probably 90% of the attorneys I know couldn't tell you how to issue a subpoena. Every subpoena issued shall be issued under the seal of the court. It shall state the name of the court and the caption of the case, and it shall command each person to whom it is directed to attend and give testimony at a time and place specified therein, right? So you can sit there and you can produce your own subpoenas, or you can just go to the tax court website, right, and download the form that they give you, which you can pre-populate in PDF. We talked about the fact that under 147B, the party can issue a subpoena ducis tecum. Let's talk about areas of relief for a subpoena ducis tecum. Sometimes parties may not want to appear to testify. Many times parties may not want to appear to testify. So the particular relief that you're requesting when a party is requesting to be relieved of either responding to a subpoena to appear at trial or responding to a subpoena ducis tecum to produce documents is to quash or to modify a particular subpoena. So if you have, let's say, situations where you have witnesses where the subpoena is requesting privileged information, you might want to file a motion to quash the subpoena or to modify the subpoena to not request the privileged information. You could also condition denial of the motion to quash on the payment of reasonable costs in producing documents. So sometimes, you know, if you're dealing with voluminous documents or, that would be a burden for the taxpayer to have to produce, you can just make those documents available for inspection. And that might be what you would deal with in a motion to modify a subpoena. A subpoena may be served by a United States Marshal, a Deputy Marshal, or by any person who is not a party and is not less than 18 years of age. A little bit less formal than what a lot of you all may be familiar in some of the state courts where you need to actually have, or in some of the states where you actually need to have, a sheriff's department serve the subpoena. The important thing to remember is that fees and mileage are required for taxpayers' witnesses, So service of a subpoena upon a person named therein shall be made by delivering a copy to that person and by tendering to that person the fees for one day's attendance and the mileage associated by law. The code actually refers you to, I think, three different sections before it finally tells you what the witness fee is. I think it's $40. $40 it does, so. Plus whatever the mileage is and travel. When the subpoena is issued on behalf of the commissioner, fees and mileage need not be tendered, right? Thought is that government employees are appearing under their official obligation to do so, not because they're being paid. Yeah?
In a pro se case, yeah. Does the court get involved in the subpoena, or does the clerk, or is it issued in the party's name?
No, I think the court's really, even though it's a pro se case, right, the courts might try and direct the parties and say, hey, here's Rule 147, please take a look at it. Or, you know, clerk of the court, please include with this order a copy of Rule 147. We've had situations at calendar calls where judges have actually pulled us aside and said, hey, can you help this guy get a subpoena issued? You know, he's got trial set and he just needs assistance telling him what to do. So the judges don't get involved in terms of actually issuing the subpoenas because they do need to be neutral, but they will direct parties to kind of either A, the right rule, or B, a clinic or something else that can help them. Yeah.
Where would you find the daily rate and the mileage rate?
That's what I was saying before. I think, so the question for people at home is, where do you find the daily rate and the mileage rate? I think it bounces you around to about three different code sections before it finally settles you in probably 18 or 28 USC, probably 28 USC. I don't specifically know the answer, but I can find out for you.
If that should be yes, because that's a good question, where would we know to find it?
You can bring up the subpoena form.
Yeah.
The subpoena form.
Oh, it's on the subpoena form. Okay,
will,
so that's
give
the
you
answer.
The instructions.
That would be the back. Thank
I will
you.
Tell you which code section.
Any other question? I thought I saw another.
Yeah. The question on the fee, does it accompany the subpoena?
Yep.
Okay.
Yes. You include the question for people at home is, does the fee accompany the subpoena? And the answer is yes. In order for the subpoena to be valid, you got to issue the subpoena.
Right.
We won't talk about contempt. We talk about fees and mileage. All right. You guys already know that all hearings and all tax court proceedings are going to be recorded, right? The transcript is evidence. I think you all know that. Let's talk about post-trial briefs for the last 30 seconds we have left. Generally, right, under Rule 151, the court can direct the filing of post-trial briefs, right? Generally, there are three types of briefs. Either you have an opening brief, an answering brief, or a reply brief, all right? The purpose of a brief is to assist the trier of fact, the judge. Sometimes the judge feels it necessary to have the parties brief the issues. Sometimes the judge doesn't think it's necessary for the parties to brief the issues. All right, the way that briefs work, you write your brief, you submit it and electronically file it with the court. The clerk of the court really serves two documents, right? They serve the petition and they also serve the actual briefs that are filed. The actual briefs that are filed will be filed once all the briefs are submitted and filed with the court. So the clerk will wait to serve them on all the parties until it actually is on. For any brief, you must always have a signed original and two copies. The thought is that one original is going with the file record, and then two copies, one is for the judge and one is probably for the judge's chambers. All briefs shall contain a table of contents, a statement of nature, controversy, proposed findings of fact, and a concise statement of the points on which the party relies, the argument, and the signature of the counsel. I think that's probably a good place to stop because the brief is, for the most part, kind of where your practice is going to end unless you're doing post-trial relief, which we've already spoken about, and appeals. Yeah, assessment.
What is the difference between the simultaneous brief and the seriatim brief?
Yeah, so the question is, what is the difference between a simultaneous and a seriatim brief? Simultaneous brief would be both parties have opening briefs due on the same day. So government files theirs, taxpayer files theirs, both on November 1st. Right. Then after they file their opening brief, they would also file answering briefs, right? Within usually it's 30 days or 45 days, depending on what you ask the court.
The
seriatim goes, usually taxpayer goes first. So taxpayer files opening brief, government files answering brief, taxpayer files reply brief.
Seriatim is a reply brief.
Seriatim, no, seriatim is, yes.
It requires a reply.
Yes.
But not the sound.
It's just, the real thought about seriatim, if you think about it, it's really saying one coming after another. That's really what seriatim means. Right, simultaneous is at the same time. Yes?
Parties choose whether it is seriatim or seminal.
You can, I'm sorry, you said the judge choose?
Yes.
Usually the judge chooses. You can request, right? I mean, I like seriatim briefs. I like any opportunity that I get to talk more than my opponent, right? So I will set the issues in my opening brief, let the IRS respond, and then try and defeat their arguments in a reply brief. Judges, because they are mindful of that, they want to give both parties an equal opportunity to respond, so they do their briefs simultaneously. Does that make sense? All right. Thank you all. I know it's a late night, so thank you. Wow, it's good. And the rest is just to teach you about practice and procedure before the tax court that you should all know, right? Practice and procedure before the tax court. Knowing how it ends should inform how it begins, right? Knowing how a tax court case plays out will tell you how to prepare the return. What to think about when you're preparing the return, how to go to appeals, how to deal with compliance. Knowing the end helps you know what you should do at the beginning. So even if you're not taking the exam, I highly commend that you look at the materials that Larry prepared for this class. I mean, they are the most comprehensive, organized materials about how to practice before the tax court. All right, exam is in November. It's going to be one last class after this, which is going to be ethics, and then we may have one more practice exam. If there's anything else that the class needs in terms of cramming, in terms of things, we may do a session of just your frequently asked questions on things that people are still getting wrong on the practice exams. I want to get you through the questions that have been asked at least three times in the last five exams, because if you can get the repeats, then you're really on your way to passing. All right, with that, you met Larry last time. He's going to finish up practice and procedure. Next calendar call, for those of you who haven't gone to a calendar call, October 31st, the judge is Peter Panuthos. It's an S case calendar, and I believe that representatives of all the local low-income tax clinics are there. It should be a good calendar to watch. Again, the people who were there at the last calendar, everything that was done was something that may be on an exam, whether it be the rules of evidence, some substantive procedures, some substantive questions, as well as the practice and procedure. All right. So October 31st, for those of you who want to come to one last calendar call to see how it all plays out and how it all comes together. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Larry. Thank you, Larry.
Thank you, Frank. Hello, everyone. Part two of tax practice and procedure. Just for those of you who weren't here last week, bring up to speed real quick on what we covered. If you have any questions about these specific items, just talk to me at the break and we can go through them. We talked about the scope of the tax court rules and preliminary concepts about tax court litigation. We talked about the tax court as an institution. We spoke about the tax court's jurisdiction, which we found is pretty broad, and is definitely an area that is tested on the tax court exam. We spoke about the effect of bankruptcy and how it operates as a stay on tax court proceedings. We also discussed the statute of limitations and when a tax return is actually considered filed by the IRS. We introduced you to the two items necessary to invoke the tax court's jurisdiction. One, a validly issued notice of deficiency, and two, a timely filed petition with the tax court. We also talked about commencement of the case, including certain rules regarding filing of papers and form and style of papers. We started talking about pleadings last time. We talked about the pleadings pretty generally. What we didn't cover and where I want to start tonight is with respect to the actual documents that are filed in the tax court, which make up kind of the pleading process. So our starting point is actually going to be the petition. The tax court rules are pretty clear about what must be included in a petition. Generally, anytime you're dealing in any type of litigation, the party bringing the case, whether that be a private party in a private cause of action, or the
United States in the case of a criminal case and certain civil cases, files a document to commence the case. In the tax court, typically in most courts that's known as a complaint, but in the tax court it's actually known as a petition. And generally the petition is the initial pleading that effectively prevents the IRS from being able to assess the deficiency. Right, so we talked about section 6212 and section 6213. Section 6212 is going to define a notice of deficiency. Section 6213 is going to provide that a taxpayer may petition the tax court within 90 days, and that if the taxpayer so timely files one of those petitions, that any assessment or further collection of that tax is barred pending a final decision from the tax court. We'll talk about what that means, a final decision from the tax court. In terms of the actual pleading itself, we're going to talk about the requirements for the petitions. The petitions vary depending on whether you're dealing with a deficiency case, where the IRS is determining additional tax due than what was reported on the return, as compared with, let's say, a lien and levy case, a collection due process case, or a request for an innocent spouse or a partnership action, and we'll talk about the various items that get included within the petition. But it's important for you all to remember, for purposes of the exam and purposes of preparing before the appearing before the tax court, that all petitions must be written. And that's different than a lot of other courts, right? Most courts allow electronic filing of complaints and petitions in order to commence a case. Right now, okay, the tax court requires that taxpayers or taxpayer practitioners paper file a petition. The tax court actually recently adopted rules that allow the electronic filing of a petition, and you should kind of keep aware of where that stands if we're going to see any activity before your exam with respect to whether electronic filing of petitions is allowed. But right now, for purposes of your exam, keep in mind the petition must be written and it must bear an original signature of the practitioner who is appearing on behalf of the taxpayer. We had talked before that regarding the time for filing of the petition, generally that petition must be filed within 90 days if the notice of deficiency was addressed to a person inside of the United States, or it must be filed within 150 days if that notice of deficiency was addressed to somebody outside of the United States. And the materials talk about when a person is outside of the United States, and I think the tax court has tested that in the past from time to time. Regarding computation of the days, the materials talk about how you compute days. Generally, I think on your exams, they actually give you a calendar. But for those of you who are doing it at your desk, there's actually web-based programs now that will help you compute it. But if you were going to compute it by hand and counting your fingers, which might be one way that some of you who are taking the exam might do, the day of the petition is day zero, right? So you don't count that first day when you're counting, and you count forward from there. So it's zero, one, two, three. But let's talk about the contents of a petition, because what the tax court rules do is they actually set forth the general requirements for all petitions, and then they include some additional items that must be included depending upon the type of action that the taxpayer is trying to bring. So in the case of a petitioner who is an individual, all petitions must include the petitioner's name and state of legal residence on the date the petition is filed. Why does the tax court want to know that? Because you know that under Section 7482 of the Internal Revenue Code, the taxpayer's state of legal residence governs the venue for appeal. The Golson rule, we know that the tax court applies the law of the Circuit Court of Appeals in which where an appeal of the case would actually apply. In the case of any petitioner or taxpayer who is not an individual, the petitioner must state the petitioner's name and principal place of business or principal office or agency as of the date the petition is filed. And again, that requirement is there for the exact same reason. The petition must also include the petitioner's mailing address as of the date of the petition. Not surprisingly, that's so the court and the IRS can correspond with the taxpayer. The petition must also state the office of the IRS with which the tax return for the period in question was actually filed. And that is necessary so the IRS can locate the taxpayer's records. The petition must also state the date of the notice of deficiency or the liability or other proper allegations showing that the jurisdiction, that the court actually has jurisdiction to hear the case. Remember, in all these cases, right, tax court's jurisdiction is going to be predicated on a validly issued notice, right, and two, a timely filed petition. Next, the petition must state the city and state of the office of which IRS issued the notice, so that way the IRS counsel knows where to get the administrative file. The petition must also state the amount of the deficiency or liability, as the case may be, as determined by the IRS. It must state the nature of the tax, for example, either the income tax, the estate tax, the gift tax, or the excise tax, and the year or other years or periods for which the determination was made. Generally, there should be a statement in the petition that states the amounts in dispute. If the full amounts are in dispute, just state the full amount of the deficiency and the full amount of the accuracy-related penalties or failure to file penalties are at issue. If the amounts that you claim are different, right, if you concede already up front to a portion of that, we could talk about kind of the propriety of doing that as a strategy, but if you come off the bat and you already know that you're going to concede a certain credit that your client's not entitled to, you'll state the approximate amounts that are actually in controversy. This is an important one. The petition must include clear and concise assignments of each and every error that the taxpayer claims the IRS to have committed. Right, and we know that this is important because the next slide will show you that any issues not raised in the petition are going to be deemed conceded. And there are a couple of exceptions to that we'll talk about that, but the general rule is if it's not in the petition, it's not in the case. So it's important that you take time to kind of craft and think about your petition when you're filing them. The petition must also include a prayer setting forth the relief sought by the taxpayer. So in a collection case, that might be remand to appeals. In a deficiency case, it might be a determination from the court or a decision from the court that there's no tax due, or it might be a grant of relief from joint and several liability in the case of an innocent spouse case. The petition must also include the signature, mailing address, and telephone number of each petitioner or each petitioner's counsel, as well as the counsel's tax bar number, and a copy of the notice of deficiency or the other operative notice conferring jurisdiction on the court. So those are the items that are required to be filed with each petition. We talked about the fact that issues not raised in the petition are deemed conceded under Rule 34b-4. How does that relate to amendments of pleadings, right? We're going to talk about amendments of pleadings and when they are maybe allowed. But if you're faced with a situation where on your exam or in real life, where you forget to include something in the petition, don't fret. You always have the ability to amend the pleadings, and the courts generally grant leave to amend the petition freely as justice would so require. And that's exactly out of the rules. Leave shall be given to amend freely when justice so requires. It is not necessary. A lot of courts actually require that litigants state the amounts A, in controversy, and B, the amount of relief that they're trying to get from the opposing party, including any attorney's costs or administrative award costs. The tax court's different, right? They don't want a claim for reasonable litigation or administrative costs to be included in the petition whatsoever. So keep that in mind, that is not a separate requirement. You may be faced with situations where the IRS issues multiple notices of deficiency. So either they do it because they issue separate notices of deficiency, the husband and wife, for the same year, or because they issue separate notices of deficiency to each taxpayer or a taxpayer for a multiple period of years. The general rule, okay, is that a separate petition must normally be filed anytime you have a separate notice. So a notice from the IRS conferring jurisdiction on the court, a petition, right? However, Rule 34 of the tax court rules actually lets you file a single petition with respect to all notices of deficiency directed to one person alone or to more than one person, for example, a husband and wife. So if you have a husband and wife, they might get separate notices of deficiency, but they want to prosecute their case as one case. It's not a problem. You're going to attach both notices to the petition. You'll file a petition in the name of the husband and the wife. And I typically include a provision in my petition that says, the taxpayer is invoking their rights under Rule 34 to effectively consolidate the cases. And we don't want the cases separated. And we're going to talk about what consolidation of cases means and separation of cases means, actually on the next slide. So a common issue arises as to whether in a lot of other courts, you can join outside parties, right? Parties that might have collateral claims to your client's existing claim, but the tax court doesn't allow joinder of outside parties. There's a couple of exceptions to that, but as a general rule, there is no joinder of outside parties. So no person to whom a notice of deficiency or a notice of liability was issued may join with any such person in filing a petition with the court, except that it's provided in Rule 34, right? Except to the extent that it deals with, let's say, a husband and a wife or a common interest, right? If you have multiple transferees with respect to the same transferee notice. The court may order in its discretion to separate trials, which is known as a severance. So let's say that you have multiple issues joined into a single case. So you have multiple notices of transferee liability issued to individuals, but the facts are really different. And one trial would just simply confuse the judge and confuse the record. The judges may actually require that you sever those cases and try them separately in order to keep a pretty clean record. Just as a general rule, it's just a rule that you need to understand. Misjoinder of parties is not grounds for dismissal. So if parties are not properly joined or added, is not separate grounds for dismissal. Let's just talk real quickly about some of the separate requirements regarding lien and levy actions. We talked about the general rule for a petition is that it has to be filed 90 days, right, after the notice of deficiency is issued or the operative notice. There's a couple of exceptions for that. One of those exceptions is with respect to lien and levy actions. What we all know is collection due process or CDP cases, right? So a lien and levy action seeks judicial review of the IRS's determination to proceed with a collection action, right? So if you think about operatively the way it's going on, the IRS, the Commissioner of the Internal Revenue, is making a determination to collect tax. He is deciding to, and I say he because it is a he, right now at least, he is filing a lien, right? Or he is proposing to issue a levy. By the time you're in tax court, the taxpayer has already gone on to appeals and exercised administrative rights. And appeals has made the determination as to whether either A, the lien should have been filed, or B, whether the levy may proceed. What appeals does is appeals is going to go ahead and issue its notice of determination. And in the lien and levy case, the notice of determination is the operative document that confers jurisdiction on the tax court. The time for filing a petition in response to the notice of determination is 30 days from the date on the notice of determination and when it's actually mailed. There was actually a recent case that came out of the tax court that you all should be familiar with. In that case, the IRS essentially stamp dated a notice of determination, but didn't put it in the mail for, let's say, 10 days after. And the taxpayer got it and didn't file a petition. I think we actually talked about this during the last case. And the tax court said that it's not necessarily the date on the notice of determination that controls when the notice of determination is issued, it is when it is placed into the mail system. So just keep that in mind. There was no relief granted to the taxpayer in that regard. Had there been, I think a collection statute would have expired for the taxpayer. But what the tax court actually held is the time for computing that 30-day period is when the notice of determination is placed in the mail. What does that tell you, right? It tells you that when you're filing a petition in response to one of these notices, you know that the earliest date that it was going to be placed in the mail, assuming that the IRS did what it was supposed to do, is going to be the date stamped on the notice, right? So you always go off that date, and to the extent that there are exceptions, and for some reason the IRS delayed putting it into the mail service, and that's going to come up during subsequent litigation. As we had talked about, a lien and levy action is commenced by filing a petition with the court. The requirements are generally going to be the same with respect to a notice of deficiency petition. There's going to be a couple of differences that I'll note for you. In the case of a notice of deficiency petition, a petition in response to a notice of deficiency, generally we call our petition a petition, right? It's just called a petition, that's it. When you're dealing with a lien and levy action, you're actually going to call a petition for lien action under section 6320C, or a petition for levy action under section 6330D. And those code sections are the operative provisions that are going to confer jurisdiction on the court to hear those cases. Before I had mentioned, the requirements are going to be the same. So you're going to state the petitioner's name and state of legal residence for the exact same reason I already mentioned. Or if you're dealing with an entity as a taxpayer, you're going to set forth the taxpayer's principal place of business or principal office. Again, you're going to include the taxpayer's mailing address as of the date of the petition. You're going to include the date of the notice of determination as opposed to the date of the notice of deficiency. You'll include the city and state of the office of the IRS, which made the determination. And we talked about this is going to be appeals. This isn't going to be the actual revenue officer dealing with. It's going to be the appeals settlement officer that you were dealing with, or the appeals officer you're dealing with. You will state the amount or amounts and type of underlying tax liability that were at issue, and the year or years or other periods to which the notice of determination actually relates. Again, right, same requirement in 34b-4, we're going to include clear and concise assignments of error, right, as every allegation. We're going to set forth everything we can possibly think of. We'll throw in the kitchen sink in our petition, and we'll sort it out during discovery, which we're going to talk about in a little bit. Really the only limitation on that is that you all, as a soon-to-be member of the bar, will have an obligation to only assert, right, reasonable and good faith arguments, right, reasonable and good faith logical extensions of either existing law or application of fact to law. So it's important to remember that that is really the only limitation. The last item we'll talk about are frivolous submissions. And you'll see a lot of tax court decisions that deal with frivolous submissions, and we'll talk about kind of what makes a submission frivolous and how to avoid it. We're going to include the prayer setting forth relief sought by the taxpayer. We're again going to include the signature and mailing address and telephone number of each taxpayer. And instead of the notice of deficiency, here in a lien and levy case, we're going to include a copy of the notice of determination, right, which is the operative document conferring jurisdiction on the court. Generally, when you're dealing with, and we know that innocent spouse, right, you guys have, I think, an entire class on innocent spouse. We know that innocent spouse can come up a whole bunch of different ways, right? We know that we can have standalone innocent spouse requests, right? That's when your taxpayer files Form 8857 with the IRS, and you go through the whole process of getting the response from the non-requesting spouse. But we also have situations where innocent spouse relief can be requested in connection with a deficiency case, right? And it also can be requested in connection with collection cases. So we're going to assume here, and the tax court rules have separate provisions for these standalone innocent spouse cases. These are cases brought under Section 6015E of the Internal Revenue Code. But generally, an action for relief from joint and several liability requests, judicial review of an IRS determination to not grant relief to a spouse from joint and several liability. Generally, any petition in response to one such notice, a notice of determination denying relief from joint and several liability, must be filed within 90 days, right? So again, we're going back to that general 90-day rule. And generally, as all of these cases are gonna be, you commence this case, with the exception of a few that are commenced by way of a motion, all of our cases that we're talking about now are gonna be commenced by way of a petition. The rules, again, are gonna be relatively straightforward and pretty consistent with what we've already spoken about. I'll highlight for you the differences. When you're dealing with a standalone innocent spouse case, the petition filed is known as a petition for determination of relief from joint and several liability on a joint return. Just include it as the title. You don't want the court to have to bounce your petition for kind of silly reasons.
Is there any designation on the petition noting that it's a 615 case?
Yeah, it's a good question. So Evan, just for the people at home, Evan's question was, is there any indication on the petition that you can make to let the court know that it's a standalone innocent spouse case?
Or for that matter, a lien and levy.
Or a lien and levy case is the follow-up. Is there any way that you can designate on the petition to let the court know that? The short answer is, if you use, the tax court makes available, I think it's Form 1 or Form 3, a sample petition. It's a one-page simple petition that you can use to file a case that you might do if you're, you know, brushed right up against that 90-day deadline. You can actually check the box and do exactly what Evan is suggesting. But once you all are admitted to practice before the court, you're going to start developing your own pleadings about what you like included and what you don't want included. Because that simple one-page petition is not going to assume all the different allegations that you're going to want to raise. So once you're actually admitted to the court, or for those of you who already are, you're not going to be able to simply check a box. You're going to have to allege, just like you would in any other court, right? You're going to have to state facts that make your claims plausible, right? Generally, we look at facial plausibility in terms of pleadings. But hopefully that answers your question. Again, all of our other requirements are gonna, for the most part, stay the same. These requirements are gonna be set forth in Rule 321. The big difference between all these cases is that you'll again include that copy of the notice of determination. And if you actually didn't get a copy of the notice of determination, because the IRS took longer than 6 months to actually issue it, you will include a copy of the election for relief that the petitioner filed. So generally, right, you can request innocent spouse relief in response to a notice of determination. The exception to that rule is if you make a request for relief from joint and several liability, innocent spouse relief, and the IRS doesn't act within 6 months, you can then petition the tax court to invoke the tax court's jurisdiction, and you'll have to include a copy of really your Form 8857 to your petition. In partnership actions, let's just talk real quickly about these. Frank, these are covered on the exam?
Yeah, not too many questions about
it. All right, just quick. So we'll kind of brush over it real quick. There are a number of different partnership actions that can be brought within the tax court, right? You can have run-of-the-mill partnership actions, which are covered in Tax Court Rule 241. You can have large partnership actions, which are covered in Tax Court Rule 301. And now, right, the tax court has actually proposed new rules. We talked about last time, the budget, what is it?
Bipartisan?
Yeah, the Bipartisan Budget Act of 2015, right? Which basically, in many respects, most material respects, eliminates TEFRA, right, and now replaces it with a partnership level assessment. The tax court actually recently adopted rules regarding those additional items. The contents of the petition are going to be different based on who's bringing the case. When you're dealing with a partnership case, right, if it's a TEFRA partnership, so a partnership that is subject to the Tax Equity and Fiscal Responsibility Act of 1982, right, you are normally going to have an individual known as a tax matters partner. That is going to be the person who is designated on the tax return for the partnership as the person who is authorized to represent the partnership before the Internal Revenue Service. When you have the operative document conferring jurisdiction on the court, it's going to be known as what is known as a Notice of Final Partnership Administrative Adjustment, okay? That Notice of Final Partnership Administrative Adjustment, which the court often refers to as an FPAA, is what confers jurisdiction on the court. You might have other situations where the tax matters partner, right, the person who's supposed to prosecute the claim actually doesn't. And in those situations, the statutory rules and the court rules allow any other notice partner, right, any other individual whose income liability is directly or indirectly determined by reference to the partnership's allocations of income, deduction, gain, and loss, to petition the court. And they have an additional 60 days. So after the tax matters partner doesn't petition, then these notice partners can come in within the following 60 days to petition the court. Generally, a petition initiating a partnership action should be entitled a partnership for readjustment of partnership items under section 6226. That's if it's the tax matters partner who's bringing the case, or a petition for adjustment of partnership items under section 6228. As you might expect, the rules are going to be very, very similar to what we already had. The primary differences, okay, are going to be with respect to stating the name and stated legal residence of the taxpayer, who's actually the tax matters partner. So the tax matters partner or the notice partner is actually going to be your petitioner in those cases. And that's an important distinction to know. And you also note that the name and principal place of business of the partnership at the time the petition is filed must also be included. When you're, just as an aside for those of you who are already litigating, once you're actually going through and you're picking out and deciding, you know, when to file a petition, to the extent that you have a business that can be easily relocated, you can actually do some forum shopping in connection with picking out what appellate venue would apply by reestablishing your business to a different circuit. And I know that there are situations where you've had, let's say, a taxpayer who is located in New York City, which would be appealable to the Second Circuit Court of Appeals, relocate to New Jersey to take advantage of more favorable law under the Third Circuit Court of Appeals, which is what applies in New Jersey. So for those of you who are doing this pretty regularly, just keep in mind that you know you can be fairly strategic as you're filing these petitions. Let's move along to the next one. We've talked about the petition. Those are the requirements I actually just spoke about on the slide. Sorry we didn't jump ahead. There are also, the tax court has jurisdiction to redetermine employment status, right? So if the IRS comes in and they reclassify certain employees from independent contractors to employees, the employer can actually redetermine or petition the tax court for a redetermination of employment status. Generally, a petition for redetermination of employment status under section 7436, which is what you should title your documents, must be filed within 90 days after you get the work classification notice. The contents of those petitions are going to be set forth in Rule 291B. So if you get these questions, right, I mean, on your exam, the way it comes up is briefly describe, and they'll give you 2 minutes, briefly describe the requirements that must be included in, let's say, a general petition. You'll know, just real quickly, that you jump to Rule 34, right? To the extent that you get a question that says, explain the requirements that must be included in actions for redetermination of employment status. And most of you are probably thinking to yourself, all right, I understand work classification, but I didn't memorize this. Go to the tax court rules, right? Go to the index, look up, and keep an eye. You know that there's a separate section indexed for, right, employment status or employee reclassification or declaratory judgments. And you'll see the rule. All you're going to do is flip to the rule, and then that'll trigger your memory, and then you'll start writing. And really, if you make use of the index, for those of you who are taking this tax court exam, I think you can save yourselves A, a lot of time, and B, get yourselves a lot of points. there are a variety of ways that taxpayers can request what is known as declaratory judgment from the tax court. And essentially, in these declaratory judgment cases, taxpayers seek judicial review of an IRS determination with respect to some act that the IRS is taking, right? And there are a whole bunch of different acts that fall within these declaratory judgment actions. You might have the qualification of a particular retirement plan or certain exempt organizations, their status as, let's say, a tax-exempt entity subject to a declaratory judgment action. So the taxpayer goes in, they file their request to be recognized as a tax-exempt organization. The IRS initially grants it, and then over the course of time, the IRS, let's say, revokes that tax-exempt status. Well, the IRS's taking of that designation, right, is a due process. It's a taking of someone's property. Taxpayers have due process rights in response to the taking of that property. That due process right that they have takes the form of a declaratory judgment action. They can seek judicial review from the tax court in order for review. The other areas where these declaratory judgment actions come up is in the valuation of certain gifts, the status of certain governmental obligations as tax exempt, the eligibility of an estate with respect to an installment plan, an installment payment plan under section 6166, and the treatment of certain partnership items with respect to over-sheltered returns. The materials that you have go into each of these items significantly more in detail. I don't know if it really warrants you taking the time to memorize it. Just be familiar with where it is in the rule. Frank?
There's only two of are frequently tested. Tax court's ability to revalue the gifts and the tax court's jurisdiction under the installment plan, right? So you're getting our grids, right, of all the prior exams and the answers. Those are the two that are most frequently tested on the exam. You know, does the tax court have jurisdiction to revalue the gifts? Does the tax court have jurisdiction with respect to the installment payments under 6166? Those are the repeats, right? Between now and the exam, you're going to see our grids going over the questions that have been asked over the last five exams, the questions that have been asked three or more times out of the last five exams, and your studying should read the grids, hit the hyperlinks that will bring you to the rule, and then Larry told you exactly how to remember the exam. Use your table of contents to bring you to the rule. If you look at the grids, look at the old exams, practice with your table of contents when you're using the practice exams. That will hold you in good stead for the exam being given in November. And sometimes when a case comes into your office, say, hey, can the tax court do this without me paying first and going for a refund? Thank you, Larry.
Yeah, thanks, man. Just for the people at home, Frank was saying that the primary area of focus is on in the declaratory judgment action has been historically on the tax court exam, the valuation of gifts, and the tax court's jurisdiction to modify denial of requests for installment agreements under section 6166, estate tax installment agreements under section 6166. A separate action where the tax court has jurisdiction, right, and we spoke about this, is with respect to disclosure actions. So a disclosure action, right, is an action where the taxpayer is seeking judicial review of an IRS determination to disclose or not to disclose certain publicly available information and written determination and background files. So if you think about, right, some of you may be familiar with the fact that the IRS processes tech advice memorandum and that those tech advice memorandum actually relate to actual taxpayers. A lot of taxpayers might want to try and discover earlier drafts with respect to that tech advice memorandum. To the extent that the IRS is refusing to disclose that information, then the tax court may have jurisdiction to do it. A disclosure action must be filed within 60 days of the disclosure notice, so keep that in mind. As we had talked about, a disclosure action is commenced by filing a petition with the court. That petition is known as, if you're seeking disclosure of IRS information, petition for additional disclosure. If you want to prevent the IRS from actually disclosing information, as let's say the estate from wanting to not give certain information to a beneficiary, you would call that a petition to restrain disclosure or to disclose identity. Actions for administrative costs is another area. And if you think about really what we're doing, we're just running through all the different areas that the tax court has jurisdiction, right? And what the courts have done is they've adopted specific rules that address, you know, the specific statutory requirements. Yes.
Those prior drafts of the tech advice memo, wouldn't they be protected under either attorney-client privilege or private confidentiality?
They most likely would. That's a good point. I was just throwing an example out there. For people at home, the question was, would prior drafts of tech advice memorandums be subject to attorney-client or work product? I think the short answer is they'd probably be subject to attorney-client privilege. So, thank you. With respect to, was there another question? Sorry, Frank, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, it doesn't hurt to ask, right? You ask, sometimes you get, sometimes you don't.
Right. So with respect to actions for administrative costs, this is another area where the tax court has jurisdiction. An action for administrative costs seeks judicial review of an IRS determination to not award administrative costs in connection with an administrative hearing where the taxpayer was a substantially prevailing party, right? And we're going to talk about qualified offers and settlement of tax court cases in a little bit. We'll talk about what it means to actually be a substantially prevailing party under the Internal Revenue Code. We know that the tax court also has jurisdiction to review the IRS's failure to abate certain types of interest. And we know from our discussion of jurisdiction, the tax court actually recently got broader jurisdiction in this regard. So that is a key area for break for testing, right? Actions for review for failure to abate interest. An action for review for failure to abate interest seeks judicial review of the IRS's determination to not abate interest. So section 64 of the Internal Revenue Code sets forth various reasons that the IRS can abate interest to the extent that a taxpayer requests an abatement of interest and the taxpayer and the IRS refuses to abate that interest. The taxpayer can file a petition for review of failure to abate interest under section 6404. That petition must be filed within 180 days of the day the notice of determination is issued. So 6 months. There are a couple of outliers, right, that are outside this 90 and 30 day requirement. So it's just important to keep that in mind for purposes of your exam, that generally taxpayers have 180 days to commence an action for failure to review, failure to abate interest. Whistleblower actions. We talked about this last class, and this is an area that has really, really just kind of boomed in the tax court. Right? I think since 2014, there have been 14 different whistleblower cases. As we talked about last week, a whistleblower action seeks judicial review of an IRS's determination not to award certain key TAM, it says key tax, key TAM payments by an individual who believes he or she is entitled to them. Generally, any whistleblower case must be filed within 30 days of the date that the notice of determination is issued. And a whistleblower action is obviously filed by commenced by filing a petition with the tax court. That petition is known as a petition for whistleblower action under section 7623B4. So again, if you get, you're going to get the whistleblower questions, right? You know this already, and Frank's been talking about it and harping on it over and over and over again. Just keep in mind what the additional requirements are for the whistleblower. And we talked about that, right? It's just generally to include the appropriate name and to make sure that it's filed within 30 days of the date that the notice of determination is issued. We talked about bankruptcy last class, so I'm not going to harp on another to say that there were recently, for those of you who weren't here last class, recently the tax court adopted and changed new rules regarding the bankruptcy provisions. It also adopted express rules that now make the automatic stay that generally applies anytime there is a bankruptcy case to also extend to collection cases and to innocent spouse requests. So traditionally, through section 11362 USC 362A8 applies and gives rise to an automatic stay anytime a bankruptcy petition is filed, such that the tax court proceedings are automatically stayed, right? You don't have to ask for it. It's automatically stayed. All you need to do is notify the tax court of the filing of the bankruptcy petition. Generally, historically, that is applied to deficiency cases, and the courts have extended that to really all other areas of the law. But now the tax court has adopted express rules, which again are crime testing ground for y'all.
Have you formally notified that the court has to make a motion?
Yeah, you do a motion to stay proceedings, and then you know, in your allegations, you're basically advising the court that a petition for bankruptcy was filed, and typically it's actually the IRS that's going to notify the court first. Because it's a practical matter. I mean, maybe you're very involved. Maybe the practitioner is actually doing the bankruptcy work. But generally, we see that a lot of these taxpayers either are doing the bankruptcy case themselves and not communicating it to the tax controversy attorney, or they've got separate counsel who aren't aware of what the other is. Sometimes, right, the same counsel might do both, but I think controversy attorneys who are well-versed in bankruptcy practice are kind of the exception, not the norm. I'm not saying that's a good thing. I think it's just the way it is. Okay, so we talked about operative documents. Let's talk generally about the IRS's answer. So we know that the taxpayer commences a case in tax court by filing a petition. We know that there can be like one of 20 different petitions that can be filed with the tax court, and they cover the full gamut of everything within the tax court's jurisdiction. Well, the IRS now has to be given an opportunity to respond to the taxpayer's allegations, because that's all the really taxpayer is doing, right? They're making allegations in a petition that is kind of setting forth and giving notice to the court and the IRS of their claims, and now the IRS has an opportunity to respond to it, and that document is typically known as an answer. As a practical matter, we'll just start with the general rules, and then I'll give you kind of a separate insight. The answer is the IRS's responsive pleading. All right, generally, the IRS has 60 days from the date the petition is served within which to file an answer. So generally, petition is filed, IRS has 60 days to answer. The only exception to that is if the IRS makes a motion with respect to the petition. And we're going to talk about the different motions that can possibly apply to pleadings. But one might be a motion to strike, let's say, the petition, right? Or it might be a motion to dismiss for failure to state a claim. Or it might be a motion to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction. The IRS generally has 45 days to move with respect to one of those dispositive motions eliminate the petition. Then, once the tax court actually rules on that motion, the IRS will then have 60 days to file its answer. So general rule, 60 days has the IRS has 60 days to file. The only exception is if there is a motion filed, that motion must be filed within 40 days from the date that the petition is filed. And we talked about some examples that might apply. Under Rule 36B of the tax court proceedings, right, a lot of people are going to tell you that the IRS's answer is a useless document, that it doesn't do anything more than really deny the allegations of the petition or claim that the counsel doesn't have actual knowledge. And in many respects, that's true, but not all respects, right? The tax court rules really do impose a higher requirement on the IRS, and the answer should be drawn so that it will advise the petitioner and the court fully of the nature of the IRS's defenses. So if the IRS should be stating its defenses within its answer, right? But as a practical matter, it often does not. The answer must contain a specific admission or a specific denial of each material allegation in the petition, but, right, if the IRS lacks knowledge or information sufficient to form a belief as to the truth of an allegation, then that's what the IRS should say, right? Lack information or knowledge sufficient to form a belief as to the truth of the allegation. The answer must contain a clear and concise statement of every ground, together with the facts in support thereof, on which the commissioner relies and on which the commissioner has the burden of proof, right? For example, fraud. What I think you generally find in a lot of these answers is that the IRS doesn't actually set forth any elements on which it has the burden of proof. And we recently filed, in certain cases where penalties have been at issue, motions to actually strike the IRS's responsive documents. To try and get a more concrete response from the IRS as to what their case is all about, because you can't figure it out for most of these answers. The general effect of an answer is that every material allegation in the petition that is not expressly admitted or denied in the answer is deemed admitted. So generally you'll see in a lot of the answers that the IRS files kind of this blanket general boilerplate provision that any specific provision not expressly denied or admitted is deemed to be denied, right? So that language is intended to overcome the presumption within Rule 36. The next document within the pleading process is the reply. So to the extent that the IRS, in its answer, makes affirmative allegations, so to the extent that the IRS claims that the taxpayer is now liable for fraud, or the IRS claims that the IRS owes, that the taxpayer owes additional tax, or if the IRS claims that the amount of the deficiency or the amount of the penalty is higher than what is stated in the notice of deficiency, then the IRS is required in the answer to make an affirmative allegation to that effect. All right? Because there are affirmative allegations in the answer, right? If you think about a party, counterparty, right, or a petitioner, counterpetitioner, or a cross-claimant in some of these civil cases, the taxpayer is now put in the defensive position of having to defend against the IRS's affirmative allegations. And the way the IRS, the way the taxpayers do that is by filing a reply. And Rule 37 of the tax court rules governs what should be included in the reply. Generally, a reply to the answer, the IRS's answer, is not necessary, but it may be filed. And the reason it's not necessary is because unless the IRS actually files a motion to enforce the affirmative allegations in the answer, all matters in the answer are actually deemed denied. Right? So if you do nothing, by operation of the rules, everything is going to be denied. Every affirmative allegation in the IRS's answer is going to be denied.